Both teams have had a spirited week in practice. And how about these Volunteers? There's Mose Phillips going after that Vanderbilt tackling dummy. And then a shot for James Stewart as well. Those running backs don't get to tackle people very often.
When they start doing tackling, you know you're in trouble. But don't they love to hit that dummy?
Well, we have a couple of record opportunities for both teams today on an individual basis. And to talk about that, here's Bob Kessler.
Okay, Bob, thanks a lot. It should be an interesting game on the ground today. It features the number one and number two rushing teams of the SEC. Both think that's their forte. James Little-Man Stewart has a shot to become the all-time leading rusher in Tennessee history. Needs 84 yards to pass Johnny Jones and 231 yards to become the first Tennessee running back to get 3,000. And Ronnie Gordon, the Vanderbilt quarterback's had an outstanding year. He scored 13 rushing touchdowns. He needs 12 more points today to become the all-time leading scorer in Vanderbilt history. So two guys to keep an eye on today, James Little-Man Stewart and Ronnie Gordon. They'll be key players today.
Jerry DiNardo with a chance for Vanderbilt's first winning season since 1982. That's also the last time they beat Tennessee. And DiNardo, of course, was SEC Coach of the Year a couple of years ago when he went 5-6. Philip Fulmer, at the age of 44, his second full season, third year at the helm of the Volunteers. And they're looking to go 7-4, finish strong, and go to a pretty good bowl game. Tennessee won the toss. They've deferred. Vanderbilt will receive the kickoff. John Bexford on the kick. Vanderbilt's Gabe Banks fumbling the ball in the air at his own 9 and getting it back. That cost him some precious time, and the first man there was Craig King on special teams to make the stop. Craig King had a pretty good ball game against Kentucky last week at linebacker, by the way. And there's Ronnie Gordon, the sophomore from Albany, Georgia. He's averaging 147 total yards per game, learning a little more every week as he gets a lot of playing time. Vanderbilt averages better than 230 yards a game on the ground, only 92 passing. And we expect this to be a ground battle today. Although on first down, they show three wide receivers and a single back as they try to spread out the Volunteers. Sanford Ware, the motion man. And the carry off the right side. Pretty good yardage, but the ball was fumbled, and it looks like Vanderbilt has it as Eric Lewis coughed up the ball after gaining 4 or 5 yards. Jesse Sanders on the hit. Here's our Burger King lineup for the Vanderbilt offense. Jermaine Johnson, the outstanding tailback, who's run the ball 160 times this year. They haven't thrown much to Kenny Simon lately. And up front, Richard Sines, the senior of that group, makes his 40th consecutive start. He's the center out of Houston. He has been around for a long time. Now Jermaine Johnson is in the ball game at tailback, but they give it to the first man through, and that's Eric Lewis from the fullback position. And Billy Barron, who gets the start today, is on the tackle for Tennessee. Ben Talley, the great one up front, with Steve White at the other end. Then they got Corey Stone and Barron, a redshirt freshman out of River Ridge, Louisiana, getting the start. George King, Scott Gallion and company in the middle with Tyrone Hines and Jason Parker on our Burger King lineup. Defensively is the star of that Tennessee secondary. Ben Talley in a down position on third down and 2. Full house in the backfield as they option left. And it was Gordon getting right to the 25-yard line. Problem was, he had to reach nearly the 26.
And Bob, every time you come out in a game like this and you have a weather change, the ball, the texture of the ball changes too. All of a sudden, instead of being soft, it gets real hard. And that time, Gordon chose not to flip the ball to try to get the first down on his own, and he came up short.
Larry Marmee, the Tennessee defensive coordinator, always feels that the quarterback is option one on the Vanderbilt running attack. Bill Marinangel kicking it to Nilo Sylvan, who's had some big return days lately. A low spiral that squibs off the side of Marinangel's foot, taken at the 35-yard line, and Nilo's got room across midfield. 40 yards on the kick. Jay Stallworth on the tackle as Nilo Sylvan, who's returned the ball for a 30-yard average the last two games, gets the Vols in good field position for Peyton Manning. True freshman out of New Orleans, completing 62% of his passes so far. Throwing for an even 1,000 yards with almost a 2-to-1 touchdown to interception ratio, 9-to-5. Can't ask for better field position on your first possession of the day. Stewart running off the left side, corralled from behind by Mark Jepko. And James Stewart, 84 yards away from that Johnny Jones all-time Tennessee record. Our Burger King Tennessee offensive lineup. Moes Phillips, the fullback, who does some great blocking for Stewart. Joey Kent and Kendrick Jones, good receivers. And up front, they are outstanding. Kevin Mays closing out his career. He's the only senior there at left guard. Not much there on second and four.
One of the things that Vanderbilt has told us is that they're going to put a lot of players in the box today. They're going to try to get up there to get penetration, stop the run.
Vanderbilt giving up 146 yards a game on the ground. They've got some good ones up front. Manley and Boykin are tough tackles. They're a little bit young in the secondary. Anthony Asma, true freshman now starting, with redshirt freshman Matt Anderson, true freshman Corey Chavis, and Eric Vance, who's only a sophomore. On third down and two, near side, Stewart, big room, and he will score! Little man Stewart with his 11th rushing touchdown of the season. It goes 40 yards, and the Volunteers are on the board in a hurry.
Oh, what a good adjustment by Stewart on the play. Vanderbilt was thinking inside. Everybody got caught inside. He pops outside, and there's no one in front of him. He just lopes into the end zone. Everyone's trying to catch up. Good adjustment. Doesn't even look like he's running hard there.
John Bexford for the extra point. Looking for number 153 in a row, and he's got it very early. 3 minutes and 26 seconds into the game, little man Stewart gets 40 on this carry, and he's breathing down the neck of Johnny Jones for that all-time UT record. James Stewart with his 11th rushing touchdown of the season. Didn't take the Vols very long, did it? Averaging 16 yards a play on that three-play drive, and it's 7-0 early. And some of the Commodore fans have to be wondering, is this going to be a replay of a couple of years ago? Vandy played Tennessee with a record of 5-5 and some bowl hopes, and the Volunteers, all they did was beat Vandy 45-0. It was 62-14 in Knoxville a year ago. Gabe Banks just over the 20 on the kickoff return. And the Vandy offense will have to go back to work and try to put together a couple of first downs. Terry Fair, the Volunteer cornerback, number 13 on the tackle, and Ronnie Gordon goes back to work.
Well, Bob, one of the things in talking with the Vanderbilt coaches, we said, how would it affect Ronnie Gordon if they came out and all of a sudden had something go wrong? He said, we're at a stage with our program that we don't think it's going to affect him. He knows what he has to do. He has a lot of confidence in his ability, and I think you're going to see a good performance by him today.
Commodore's in the eye. And a little play action by Gordon on first down. He'll go up top, out to the right side, and the ball is juggled and dropped. Kenny Simon, the intended receiver, and there's a flag on Deron Jenkins. Interesting that the flag came out after he was juggling the football. Jenkins, number 18, the left corner, who plays a lot of man-to-man in this Tennessee secondary, and we'll check the call. Al Ford in the crew today. 15 yards from the previous spot on the pass interference.
Boy, this will loosen up a defense. You can't creep up when you do this. That ball's about 40 yards in the air. Really had a good shot at. You see the defender's right hand around the back of the receiver. Look at that. See the right hand go right up inside the back? That's evidently what he called on the pass interference.
And Kenny Simon still almost caught the ball. Simon has not caught a pass in the last two games, has caught only three in the last five games. They haven't thrown to him very much. That could be a big factor there. Ball dropped and then picked up by Jermaine Johnson. So now each Vanderbilt running back has fumbled the football, and the Commodores have been able to keep it both times.
And now if you're a coach, what you say is, okay, you've gotten that out of your system. Now you've got to hold on to the football. You see the breath coming out of Jerry DiNardo's mouth. It's cooling off here. We had a lot of rain this morning, so the field is wet, and all of a sudden the tail end of this cold front comes through, and the texture of that ball, as I was talking earlier, starts to change. It gets a lot harder.
You see two plays like that, though, Dave, you think it's got to be nerves. Those were very routine plays. on which those balls were fumbled. Second down and 12. Johnson. First man to make contact with him was Sean Summers, the strong safety from behind. He kind of set him up for George Kitt. George got the start at left linebacker today in place of Jesse Sanders. George has played very well lately. And there's number five, Jermaine Johnson, the sophomore from Carrollton, Georgia, who's had 600-yard games this year. And his season of 859 yards is the fourth best ever for a Vanderbilt running back.
9 yards to go for Vanderbilt.
Commodores have had a lot of third down opportunities this year. This one is third and nine with three wide receivers and a single back. Gordon with good time out to the near side, and that's the tight end, Jason Tomacek.
Oh, and if he made it over the 30, 45-yard line, he has a shot at that first down. He had to make it almost to the 46-yard line.
Where will they spot it? Oh, that's well short. Almost a full yard short. And they will kick the football. You figure a big guy like this out on that flank would be able to get that yardage. But some good open field tackling by the Volunteers, and Marin Angel, after a 40-yard kick, has to do it again. John Summers, the return man for Tennessee. Not Nilo Sylvan. He's hit this one beautifully. And it squirts into the end zone. That'll make it a 55-yard kick. And the Volunteers this time will start at their own 20 instead of midfield from where they scored the first time.
And now it's really important for Vanderbilt to get that penetration up front, stop that run, keep the containment, don't let them bounce outside. They actually want to force Tennessee to pass the football.
Tennessee, number two in the SEC, rushing right behind Vandy, and passing for 176 yards a game with a young quarterback who's still learning. We got some backup running backs in there, the Volunteers do. Chester Ford leading the way for Aaron Hayden. And no surprise there, Gerald Collins with the 236th tackle of his career.
They were saying that Collins was just eating this game alive. When coaches say that, you know he was just a maniac this week playing. When he played last year in this game, it was the tail end of the season. He just had a terrible game, and he said, "It's going to bring me back. I want to come back and play."
That he has, leading the team with 108 tackles coming in. Volunteers got 5 yards on that Aaron Hayden carry. And a little misdirection by the quarterback. The man in motion originally was Kendrick Jones, and he's down the near sideline, bumped out of bounds, just short of the 42-yard line in Vanderbilt territory, a 32-yard passing play.
Boy, and if you want to guess wrong, Vanderbilt has guessed wrong twice today, and both plays have hurt them. This play, they guess blitz. You'll see it from the left side of your screen. You see how quickly they come in? It's a slip screen out to the flat now. Get the cornerback, knock him out, and down the sidelines you scamper. Good effort here to get that tackle. Ratliff comes all the way across. He got a good block, I should say.
First down at the 43 of Vanderbilt. Hayden breaks a tackle, and he's inside the 30. Matt Anderson on the tackle. Kirk Williams had a shot at him near the line of scrimmage, and then he went 14 yards.
We can tell why Tennessee's a good rushing team. They get to the line so quickly. Hayden just explodes off the ball. When Manning turns around with the football, you see Hayden's already there. He doesn't even have to step back. Hands the ball now. Break tackles. A lot of people think that Hayden may be better than Stewart. Stewart, of course, has the more yards.
They both got a lot. Three wide receivers on first down at the 29. Manning out to the left flat. And on the receiving end is Billy Williams. He's a dangerous guy out there. Great speed. Billy's healthy for the first time this year, really. He told Philip Fulmer before the game last week, "Coach, I want the ball 8 times. It was a blowout, so he didn't get it that much, but he could get it that many times in a close game today. Second down and 7. Volunteers loosening things up again with 3 wide receivers and a single back. That's Hayden. Straight ahead, and he was met by Mark Jeffcoat after Brian Boykin got a piece of him to the line of scrimmage.
Well, one thing that the Vanderbilt coaches wanted to play is situation defense. They wanted to come up with that third down and 6 or 7 yard plus. They've got one here. It's about third down, about 5.5, almost 6 yards.
Volunteers, second best in the SEC this year on third down. They got 40 of those yards on the James Stewart touchdown run. Third and 5. Manning will go to the shotgun. And he improvises a bit and throws the ball away. Looked like he wanted to throw a quickie out to the right side. His eventual target was Nilo Sylvan, and he simply threw the ball away.
Well, we talk about the tackle box. It's from tackle to tackle. Look at the number of black jerseys in the tackle box. From tackle to tackle. Vanderbilt wanted to put 6, 7, even 8 people. They said they may even try 9 people up in that tackle box to force Manning to think, I've got to pass the football. Then, of course, drop off quickly into coverage.
John Bexford with a 40-yarder coming up. His longest of the year, 44 against Georgia. He's right in the middle of the field. And he's hit it well. Tailing a bit to the right, and it misses. It looked like he hit it right down the middle, and then the ball had a strange tail to it. The wind is coming straight across from the other side of the field, and the breeze pushed it wide. It stays 7-0 Volunteers. We're back to Nashville after a word from your local SEC station. Chance to tack on 3, and they have a 7-0 lead. Quick moving first quarter. John Bexford not hitting the field goals that well this year, and he just passed up a chance to tack 3 more points on to get closer and closer to the UT scoring record of Juan Revesz. Commodores at their 24-yard line on first down. Jermaine Johnson started from a deep position, and a great play. There's why they've got Tyrone Hines in there.
Oh, boy, that's great acceleration up through the hole. And that's what you want your middle backer to do when you see it. All of a sudden, you just explode up. Don't slide along the line if you've got a shot. Watch how quickly he comes into the picture, gets him in the backfield. That's what you want your middle linebacker to do. That's why he's playing.
6'2", 231, sophomore out of Brownsville, Tennessee. He caught our eye in the spring, is what Larry Marmee told us about him, and they've been watching him ever since. Second down, Andy Levin. Play action to Jermaine, and up the middle. Ball thrown well, and it's completed to Dwayne Todd. Todd catches only his 5th pass of the year, but that for great yardage all the way out to the 44-yard line. That's about a 21-yard passing play.
Well, it's a curl pattern on the left of your screen. You're going to see Todd just go down and curl around and make a big target. I wondered if he had caught the ball clean right here, had he been able to come up running, because they just gave him a shove, and he still had his feet. He could have run for some yardage.
Yeah, he's a freshman, true freshman, 6'4", 200, out of Lorain, Ohio. First down for the Commodores as they approach midfield. Banks and Simon are wide to the left and right. Ball is fumbled on the snap, and Ronnie Gordon pounces on it. That's the 3rd Vanderbilt fumble in the first 10 minutes of the game.
Well, you think nerves, and Gordon shouldn't have that problem. All that is the quarterback pulling his hands out of the center before the ball gets up. See how quickly he pulls his hands out now. He's got to jump back on the football. At least he picks it up and makes about a yard on the play.
One of the reasons the Commodores have been better, Jerry DiNardo's team this year, a turnover ratio of +1. That's 9 better than last year when they were -8. They've done a better job of taking care of the football. 3 wide receivers on 2nd and 10. The ball given off the left side. Eric Lewis, fullback on the carry. Jason Parker up from free safety to stop him. And in this Vandy running attack, the fullback is a lot more active than he is normally in the SEC. Eric Lewis has carried the football 80 times this year.
He's an important factor in this football game. Really important for Vanderbilt to keep a drive alive. The way their coaches evaluate how their offense is going is, are they controlling the football? Are they able to run that 7, 8, 9 play drive, just control that clock?
3rd and 6, and they'll throw 4 wide receivers out there. No tight end with a single back. Gordon with good time, and the ball glances off the hands of Dwayne Todd. Pretty good tight coverage by Scott Gallion, who plays the run awfully well and played the pass very well that time.
When Galleon was a real find. Once they moved him from middle backer to outside, they let him use that great speed. He can cover those backs coming out of the backfield one-on-one. That time he was just like a shadow on the receiver.
Bill Marinangel, a 40-yarder and a 55-yarder so far. Looks like the Vols are setting up. Trying to rush him heavily. Nobody can get there. End over end kick. Hits at the 13. Ball fumbled by Nilo Sylvan. That gives the coverage team plenty of time to get down there. 3:49 to go, first quarter. 7-0 Vols. We're back after this message from Carquest Auto Parts. Vandy playing at home hasn't been able to move the football very much so far. James Littleman Stewart has a 40-yard touchdown run coming into the game. He needed 84 yards to catch the all-time UT leading rusher. And there's Johnny Jones. From 81 to 84, he went into the end zone 19 times, amassed 2,852 yards for the Big Orange. But Littleman Stewart has a chance to become the big man on that rushing chart. And by the way, Aaron Hayden needed 106 yards coming into this game to pass Charlie Garner. Garner have only played 2 years, and he was number four on the all-time chart. And they give it to the first man through. That's Mose Phillips, the fullback. Mose Jephthah Phillips, one of those volunteers out of the Nashville area, played at Hillsboro High School right here in Music City. And Peyton Manning will survey a second down and seven.
One thing that Manning does not want to do is give the football up in this situation. They seem to have taken a little bit of life away from Vanderbilt. They've driven the ball twice very well. Didn't capitalize on that last drive, but they want to continue controlling the line of scrimmage.
Stewart getting outside on the left side, far sideline, and he will be out of bounds up near the 45, but there's a flag back around the line of scrimmage. And it may be a bad block drawing the flag that sprung him. 25 yards on the play. Looks like it's coming back.
Well, when you see a cornerback just glued to the receiver, you almost think holding.
Holding by the offense during the run, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, still second down.
And when the cornerback came up on this play on the top of your screen, the cornerback came up, he never got free. He just got turned right around. Kind of flashes in your picture right there. He's trying to come off, but he had to be held to get that far downfield and still be with the receiver.
That'll set up a second and 13 as the ball moves back in between the 15 and 16 of the Vols. Worst field position they've had so far. Three wide receivers on second and long. Looking to the right side. Marcus Nash on the reception. And immediately meeting him was Matt Anderson, who came up from strong safety. Nash is a true freshman out of Oklahoma. Matt Anderson, a redshirt freshman out of Texas.
Yeah, I talked to their coach. I said, Coach, you got so many freshmen back there. He said, well, for this game, they're sophomores. They played enough. That was a good come up. That's what you want to do. Wrap them up. Get those arms around them. Don't let them break that tackle. Take them down for a short gain.
Third down has not bothered the Volunteers this year. This is a third and 10. Manning unable to throw the ball quickly. Flushed out, and he will have to get out to stay safe.
Oh, I thought there should have been a penalty on that.
There's one now.
Gosh, when your quarterback runs out of bounds, you let him go. You don't compound it.
And that's Gerald Collins. That's a rather unusual mistake by a player with such experience. Evidently, emotion took over there.
That's a personal foul, if in fact it is. Oh, that's a foolish play. See, out of bounds now. Pull him down. You let him just go out of bounds. You just ease up. If anything, you put your hands up so that you don't hit him. Again, good pressure. Manning scrambles outside. Now squares up, looks downfield. Now when he goes to step out of bounds, right there, ease up.
Bad mistake by the Commodores' stellar linebacker, Gerald Collins. And then you see James Manley all over the ball carrier. Aaron Hayden and Manley spent about 20 yards together on that play.
They were dancing. Manley says, you're not going by me. It was interesting. I saw a comment by Kevin Mays who said he felt Manley was one of the best defensive tackles. He said he's big, he's strong, he's got great range along the line of scrimmage. Said he is really going to be a challenge today to play. And Kevin Mays is quite a challenge.
Hey, if they were dancing, number 56 was leading. Second down and 10. That was a Tennessee waltz to the far sideline. Manning with a late give to Hayden, and right there is Brian Boykin. It sounds like Gerald Collins has told his teammates, hey, pick me up here.
It is. You know, sometimes things like that will spur you on. A penalty like that, a foolish penalty, will all of a sudden spur you on. But Boykin gets great penetration up through the line. See him come up through the line. Now he's in the backfield. He's right in front of the ball carrier, drags him down.
Brian Boykin, 16 tackles for losses this year. And this sets up third and 14 for the Volunteers. Only two wide receivers out there. Will they throw to one of the backs? Looks like he wanted to. There's the tight end, David Horn. First down near the Vanderbilt 40-yard line. That's why they only had two men in the pattern, because the tight end was feeling his way underneath. Well, 24 yards.
Vanderbilt makes a terrible mistake on this. They were not set when they came off to the line of scrimmage on defense. They were all moving around there. Nobody knew what they were doing. They started up late. Watch the tight end just bounce in your picture. Somebody runs right on by him. I think that was Collins might have run right on by him. Now for a little defensive back, you got to stay square. You got to take that load on. That's tough.
David Horn's longest reception of the year. Aaron Hayden looking to get outside. Wrestled out of bounds by Matt Anderson. Well, suddenly the intensity of this game has picked up considerably. Number 40 had something to do with that, with the late hit by Gerald Collins. Then he got great teammate plays from James Manley and Brian Boykin. And on third and long, David Horn came up big with help from Peyton Manning. So the Vols are on the move in the final 34 seconds of the first quarter.
Well, you talk about rivalries, and this is an in-state rivalry. This is kind of bragging rights.
A lot of Tennessee alums in the Nashville area. Hayden off the left side. Collins gets it. It'll be too late to stop it for the first down. There's a flag on the play, and we'll check that out.
And that may be a face mask because it was thrown very late on the play.
Five-yard face mask against the defense. Added on to the end of the run. First down.
See the hand go across the face mask right there. You see Collins. He takes it off immediately. That keeps it from being the major penalty. But anytime the hand goes in the face mask, that's an automatic 5 yards.
Tough drive for Gerald Collins. Andy should have had the ball back a long time ago. Clock runs with 15 seconds to go first quarter. Volunteers lead it 7-0. Manning with play action. Looking right side. Corner, and the ball was dropped down around the 2-yard line by Kendrick Jones. Corey Chavis, the left corner. On the coverage, that's a senior Jones against the true freshman Chavis.
Boy, and Jones should have had this ball. He just didn't look it all the way in. Manny actually bobbled the snap a little bit. Now watch the ball come into Jones. He just doesn't come in. He looks as if he maybe was concentrating on getting down in bounds, just took his eyes off the ball and dropped it. That's something he doesn't do very often.
Actually overreached the ball. 6 seconds to go, second and 10. The pitch to Hayden. He had trouble corralling it. And then Chavis is there waiting for him on the corner. And that'll be the end of the first quarter. Tennessee on the move. They'll have a third down play coming up when we come back after a quarter at Dudley Field at Vanderbilt Stadium. 7-0 Tennessee. Skyline of Nashville nowhere to be seen on this foggy, wet, and cool football Saturday. 46 degrees at game time. And a hearty crowd has turned out for this one. A lot of orange out there, isn't there? Third down and 10 at the 23 of Vanderbilt. Four wide receivers for the Volunteers. Manning in the gun, looking left all the way. Up top, end zone, and the ball is tipped away by a pair of defenders. Is there a flag in the end zone? Yes, there is. Nilo Sylvan, the intended receiver. Matt Anderson is number 15, pleading his case.
All the defender had to do was turn around and look at the football, and he did not.
Yeah.
defensive pass interference in the end zone, 15 yards from the line of scrimmage, automatic first down.
Let's see if we can look at this again. The defender right in the middle of your screen is going to be right where, right in the middle. Again, all he's got to do is look back to the ball. Don't play the defender. Don't stick your hand up in his face.
Ball actually hit the helmet of Matt Anderson.
That was Anderson. Again, don't put your hand on his face. Reach up and get the football. See, he has his hand in the face of the receiver.
First down and goal from the 8. Penalties have killed the Commodores on this Tennessee drive. A roughing personal foul on Collins and a face mask on Collins. Pass interference on Anderson. End around. Nilo Sylvan looking for the far pylon. Touchdown, Tennessee. Nilo Sylvan running the ball for the 8th time this year. He had a 22-yard run earlier against the Gators, and he gets a touchdown, his 2nd of the year on the ground.
Well, you can't lose backside containment. That's what they do. They lose backside containment, and now it's just a sprint to the corner. And Sylvan's got that great speed. He's becoming more and more of the offense. A great punt return to return yardage, and now becoming more of a threat as a receiver.
Export for the extra point. This would be 154 in a row if he hits it. No problema. Every time it's right down the middle, and it's 14-0 Tennessee as Nilo Sylvan turns receiver into running back. 14-0 Tennessee. Will it be like years past, or will Jerry DiNardo's Commodores come up big and get something going here? Volunteers of Fulmer have handled Vandy in recent years, both under Johnny Majors and under Phillip. Commodores are going to have to come up with something offensively here pretty soon. Line drive kick taken in the end zone. I'm not sure it was taken in the end zone, but it was taken into the end zone by Gabe Banks. Here's a look at our Lee Apparel first quarter stats, and it's Tennessee dominating in most categories. And I think the key stat there is, Dave Rowe, 13 yards rushing for Vanderbilt.
Absolutely. When you're out manned 152 yards to 42 and you're only down 14 points, you have to count your blessings, because this could even be worse. Vanderbilt ought to have all the jitters out of them now. They better be ready to play football now. Just take a deep breath, go back to your offensive game plan, and play football.
A team averaging better than 230 yards a game on the ground. 3 wide receivers on first down. Option left, Gordon keeping. He's got a good seam out to the 29 or so. That'll be about an 8-yard gain on first down. It required a tackle by Terry Fair, the true freshman at right corner.
Well, a lot of times coaches can get your attention, but when you get dropped down 14 points quickly like this, that can get your attention also. Gordon takes it on his own this time, reads a nice block. It's a good block by his wide out there to get that first down yardage. Well, just about a foot short of that first down yardage.
We'll call it 2nd and a long 1. First downs have been rare for the home team, but they've got one here as Eric Lewis, the fullback, goes straight ahead.
Now, one thing Vanderbilt seems to be doing, and watching these last 2 plays, is they're splitting their linemen a little bit farther in their alignment. When they line up on the football, they were real tight in the first series, the second series, but now they seem to be splitting out a little bit farther.
By the way, that Tennessee scoring drive was 12 plays, 81 yards, eating up 4 minutes. That's not very much time for a 12-play drive. First down at the 34. Clock shows 13:50 before halftime. With 3 wide receivers in the pattern, Gordon whips it out to the near side, and the ball was way out ahead of Gabe Banks. The Commodores do a little throwing on first down. That's the 2nd time they've done that in this game. Well, he may not have thrown for much the last month and a half, but he sure run for a lot. This guy scored 13 rushing touchdowns this year, 549 yards on the ground.
He's averaging almost 4 yards a carry.
2nd and 10 at the 34. And the carry is for Jermaine Johnson. There hasn't been much for him out there so far. Shane Burton was there to meet him. And here in the second quarter, let's check in with Bob Kessling about a guy who plays over where Shane Burton is.
That's right. Defensive tackle Elon Taylor is sitting out so far this first half because of a fight he got into last week during the Kentucky game. So Taylor will be able to play in the second half, and the Volunteers are trying to make up for that. Also, Brandon Stewart is warming up at quarterback. He might be coming in next series for Tennessee.
They've got two great young quarterbacks. Jermaine Johnson, by the way, four rushes so far, minus 3 yards. Third and 10 with four receivers. Gordon's got a lot of time. Up top, left side, the ball was almost picked off. It was Jason Parker back there. This guy does it all, doesn't he?
Oh, does he ever. Parker, of course, 87 tackles. He's great on that run defense. He comes up, he's intercepted the ball. He's really the leader. Last week had 10 tackles.
And the Volunteer fans who've come over from Knoxville and some who live here like what they see so far. A fourth kick of the day coming up for Bill Marinangel, a sophomore, and Sean Summers back at his 31. Low spiral. It'll drive Summers back to the 22. He gets by the first wave. The second wave cuts it to the near side. And he was just tackled from behind by Sean Stuckey as he prepared to break wide open.
Boy, you wonder which Vanderbilt team has showed up. This is not the one that played Florida so well. Three missed tackles on that coverage.
45 yards on that kick, and the Tennessee offensive line goes back to work. What a good crew. Jason Lehman, who's been great lately. Kevin Mays, the only senior at left guard. Jeff Smith, those guys have been around for a long time. And how many starts have they made, and how many offensive lines could have guys like Smith and Bubba Miller switching positions and still getting it done? Brandon Stewart is the quarterback. James Stewart on the ball carrier as the true freshman from Stephenville, Texas, Brandon Stewart, gets to engineer this drive.
And Bob, this has been really a shock for me, this first part of this football game, because this is not the Vanderbilt team that we've heard about and watched in the past. They've been very good on defense. First downs, Tennessee is just ripping them for yardage on first downs.
Ball out just short of the 49. Stewart got it back. The ball seemed to climb up on the back of his center, and then he just picked it out of the air after it was fumbled.
And made plus yardage on it. This is pulling your hands out too fast underneath the center. And watch the ball come right up in his face. Right there. The ball's up now. Come back and get the ball. Well, I'll pick up a couple yards. Help my rushing average. Things are going right for Tennessee when that happens.
Yeah, you pick up three on that play. Here comes Stewart. He's got a first down inside the 40. And down near the 35 of Vanderbilt, Mark Jeffcoat pursuing from middle linebacker on the stop.
Well, that's just like almost like a first down yardage. And look at the yardage that he picks up. 8, 9, 10 yards on the run. They are just killing him running the football. Backs are finding the seams perfect, sliding along the line. They're just busting through the holes.
Six rushes, 80 yards for James Stewart unofficially. And he's getting very close to that all-time Tennessee record. Joey Kent, the sophomore split end, is the man who's down.
I think he got hit on the tail end of the play by Stewart. See Stewart come into the back of him there and to hit him in the back of the legs. Now he falls over the pile.
Yeah, Joey was downfield blocking on Anthony Asma.
First and 10 for Tennessee.
First down for the Volunteers at the 35. Tennessee very deep in the receiving corps, although their freshman Maurice Staley is out with an ankle. James Stewart needs 5 yards to become the all-time leading Tennessee rusher. He'll get a couple of them there. But the Commodores say, hey, if you're going to break the record against us, you're going to have to earn it.
Anthony Jordan making the tackle.
Well, one of the things that Vanderbilt's having a problem with is getting squared up with the running back. They're arm tackling. They're hitting them and holding them on, and the Stewart's pulling them for 2 and 3 yards forward. They need to slide, get in front, and stick them face mask on face mask.
Hey, how about that headgear? He looks like the Swami of running backs back there. Second down and 9. They'll call it a gain of 1. So he's 4 yards short. Manning out to the right side, and the ball on the spot to Kendrick Jones, and then Corey Chavis is not about to let go.
Brandon Seward's pass.
Well, the winner of our season-long Outback Steakhouse Gator Bowl getaway is Norman Epps from Durham, North Carolina. He's won a trip for two, including game tickets, hotel, and airfare. And congratulations to Norman. Looks like Tennessee could be playing people like Virginia, North Carolina State winner, Syracuse, Virginia Tech, all in the picture for that bowl game. And we got a guy from ACC territory winning that trip. Third down and five. Stewart looking to get outside. He's got the first down. And that appears to be a record breaker for James Littleman Stewart and the Tennessee Volunteer all-time rushing record. And it came on a third down play when they needed 5 yards.
He just busted outside. Nobody got off their blocks. Nobody slid to the play. And he just had the perfect angle. He never had to change course on the run. And you hear the Volunteer fans starting to cheer it. I think they realize, too.
I think those are probably folks with radios who just heard John Ward tell them about it. First down at the 21. Play action to Stewart. Manning into the end zone. It's a touchdown for Billy Williams. And he goes into the hedges after beating Anthony Asma. Billy Williams with the touchdown catch, his second of the season. In fact, his second straight week with a touchdown catch.
Well, just a crossing pattern going to the post. There, nobody even near him. I mean, this is just, that's just pitch and catch. Azama had the coverage on the play. Good play action fake there. Now hold him. Now, no pressure on him. Look at this. Just a perfect pass down the middle. You know, I was asking the coaches, how do you keep two quarterbacks like Manning and Stewart happy? Said you both give them both playing time. Let them see success. And they're having it.
Right down the middle. Another extra point for Bexford. Stewart broke the record for rushing. Bexford getting close to it in kicking. It is all Tennessee, 10:09 before halftime, and the home crowd very quiet at the moment. There's the leading Tennessee rusher of all time, James Stewart, passing Johnny Jones. He's 4 yards up on him. Better not get any more negative yardage. Get a little pad on that record. Now maybe they can get Aaron Hayden past Charlie Garner later today. There's number 24. Best looking headgear in college football today for those guys.
That's just to keep them warm.
Vanderbilt tacklers have not rattled those helmets very much. Here's the kickoff return by Gabe Banks. He's outside. And he's out to the 39-yard line.
Boy, you look for positive plays. That's the first positive play that Vanderbilt has had. They've only run 13 plays in this game so far. That's incredible.
Yeah, that doesn't enable you to use much of that playbook.
First and 10.
You can write the playbook on the back of a postage stamp. You only run 13 plays. You don't need a playbook.
Jim Foster alongside the head women's basketball coach at Vandy. They had a great win over number 5 Purdue yesterday. He's got it going next door at Memorial Gym again this year. First down at the 40. Fake right, option left. Gordon keeping. He'll get a couple before he runs out of room.
Well, Bob, you start to think in a situation like this, when you're down 21 to nothing, it's early in the football game, if you're a coach on the sideline, it's not time to yell. It's a time to instruct. It's a time to get your players' attention and say, okay, listen, nothing we've done has gone right. What we need to do is get back to the game plan, execute. One thing they need to do is huddle up farther away from the ball. They huddle about a yard from the ball.
Yeah, it's almost as if Tennessee can hear them.
I know. I thought, you can hear the play.
Second down and 6. Eric Lewis, the fullback. And he'll get about 4.5 yards. They're going to be left with 3rd and 2 or so. Jesse Sanders on the tackle from left inside backer.
I think that was Hines' first miss as a linebacker that time. He's sliding along the line. There he is, number 47. Slide, 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 come up. Now he comes up a little bit early and misses the tackle. That's something he doesn't do very often.
A moment ago, you saw number 91 of Tennessee. That's Jonathan Brown, the true freshman. They think he will be the man to take over for Ben Talley eventually on that down position at the left end. Vandy, an 0-for on third down today. Gordon keeps on the option, and he just did manage to stumble for the first down after Jesse Sanders tripped him.
Boy, it was close, too. If he hadn't put his left hand down, I think it was his left hand, that kind of propelled him to the first down yardage. But he got tripped up a little bit early before the first down. Again, watch this. He's going to keep it himself. No risk of a pitch fumble. Now, he sees that first down marker right there. He trips him, put the right hand down, and kind of propels him. He didn't make it by much.
Vandy into Tennessee territory. Only the second time they've been there today. They're down 21-0. Gordon will drop back and throw it to the right. Same pattern that misfired to Gabe Banks before. This one was a little closer, but unsuccessful.
And that's not where you want to throw the ball. When your wide receiver has that much separation from the corner, you want to lay it up to him. Give him a chance to catch it. Don't throw it short behind him. You see Jerry DiNardo, what he's doing is he's talking to the coaches up top saying, what do you see? What's going to work for us? So far, not much.
I have a feeling the answer was a lot of orange. Don Fries, the offensive coordinator, with DiNardo trying to figure out how to move the football here. They've thrown it six times. Second down and 10. Gabe Banks, the motion man, near side. They look to the left for Jermaine Johnson. Pretty good play at the line of scrimmage by Shane Burton, who fought off a blocker. Got a trip on him, and then Jesse Sanders was there to finish things.
Burton was one of those people that had to move inside his defensive end, and then, of course, moved inside. He's done very, very well.
And that's Scott Gallion, the junior out of Seymour, Tennessee. I got some good inside people with George Kidd, Tyrone Hines, Gallion. They'll all be back. Jesse Sanders, he's a junior. Craig King's a sophomore. Linebacking will be a strength for Tennessee for a couple more years. Third down and 7.
A lot of people in the box.
Gordon with time to hang in there. Up the middle, ball thrown behind Kenny Simon.
Boy, Gallion never had a chance. He just never threw that. Gordon never threw that football where it should have been thrown. He just looked like he got quick feet in there. He was a little bit panicky and never squared up and delivered the football straight. Got to take a deep breath, young man. You got to look downfield. Got to have confidence in that offensive line.
And this is Simon, the ex-quarterback. And they really haven't been able to get the ball to him for the last 5 games. He's only caught 3 in the last 6, including a half today. Aaron Angel on 4th and 7. He's looking for that left corner. Came up a little bit short, and the fair catch by Sean Summers at the Vols 14. 31 yards on the kick, 7:46 before halftime. Tennessee looking to go 7-4. Looking good in Nashville. 7:46 before halftime. Tennessee leads it 21-0. Stewart, Sylvan, and Williams touchdowns. Championship ice skating comes to Nashville tomorrow, the Music City Invitational, starring Olympic gold medalist Oksana Bayul, Katarina Witt, and 5 other world champs. They're competing in Nashville's Municipal Auditorium tomorrow at 7. Ticket information at the bottom of your screen. Also an 800 number, 834-5678. And then Thursday, December 1st, they're at the Mid-South Coliseum in Memphis. The first post-Olympic competition for Witt, Bayul, and Nancy Kerrigan. Special exhibitions by reigning world champion Elvis Stoiko. Rock and roll figure skating spectacular coming up in Nashville and in Memphis. First down and 15 for the Vols. Aaron Hayden on the carry. Maybe we'll see a little more of him now that James Stewart has the rushing record.
Well, there's sure no drop-off in talent there between Hayden and Stewart. That time Hayden came up to the pile. The pile was blocked. He just bounced outside. Vanderbilt again, not getting rid of their blocks, not shedding their blocks and moving to the ball. And he just got the corner and picked up again. First down, 8 yards on first down.
Look at Florida over Florida State. Wow, 24-3, not even halftime yet. Second and 2. And a swinger out to the left side for Billy Williams. They love him on the corner one-on-one. And that's why. Tough to tackle in the open field. And they'll get 8 yards and a first down on that play.
Yeah, Zama's got to come up quicker on that play. When that receiver just takes a step and then steps right back, that cornerback's got to come up quick. Zama comes up now. When you come up, see how far back he is? Now he just gets an arm on him. He flings them off, and now he picks up 8-9 yards on the play.
Here's a trivia question for our folks watching today, Dave. Who's the only team in the preseason AP top 5 who is still in the top five. We'll give you folks one play to think about. First down at the 31. Play action. Stewart up the middle. And a man open is Jones. He will score, but he fumbles. He might have been thinking about the celebration. And the ball is fumbled out of bounds just outside the five-yard line.
Oh, and you talk about things going wrong and going right. He fumbles, yes, but he fumbles out of bounds. Great play action fake again. Holds the linebackers. Now go up top. Here he comes. Running right down here. Looks the ball in. What a great stretch. Good concentration. Back in the run. Now watch what happens with the ball. Oops. But it goes out of bounds.
64-yard pass play. It should have been 69 for a touchdown. Nice work by our crew to be on top of that one. Steve Wiggins, our man down there. First and goal from the five. Hayden into the end zone. Tennessee scores again. James Manley was riding him.
Yeah, riding him is the question. What is he doing riding him? He's a defensive tackle. You got to slide. You can't arm tackle these people. And they're just dragging him along into the end zone. They just have not moved to the ball well. Everything that could go wrong for Vanderbilt's gone wrong. Again, watch this play. Come in, defensive lineman, you got to slide. You can't just put an arm around his waist, because look what happens. He pulls you all the way into the end zone.
John Bexford with another. That's four today and 156 consecutive. And Aaron Hayden got the ball into the end zone for the Volunteers. And this one is not turning out so far the way it was previously billed. This was supposed to be a tough, tight football game.
Absolutely. We thought Vanderbilt would come out here. We knew they had a strong defense. We thought they would be able to come out here and run the ball, control the ball on the line of scrimmage down on the ground, and they've done anything but that. But 2 weeks ago, who would have given Bexford a chance to break that record of Revez? Nobody. Needed 12.
Yeah, but some people would have said, you've got Kentucky and Vandy coming up. You've got a chance for some touchdowns.
I would have thought that maybe a little bit against Kentucky.
Here's Philip Fulmer talking about his outstanding place kicker.
Well, I certainly hope he does get the record, needing, five extra points, I think, to set an all-time NCAA record. That's a great compliment to John, but that's also a great compliment to our offense and our style that we've been able to score that many points during his career here. And I hope he gets it today, because that means we've got a good chance to win.
Four for four today. He has missed a field goal. One more to tie Miami's Carlos Huerta. And the kickoff. And there's a flag down. Somebody might have been offsides on the kicking team. Ball is returned out to about the 28-yard line. Gabe Banks.
Well, that's exactly what that flag is. It was thrown right along the line of scrimmage where the kickoff team came up on the line. You see him indication. Offsides.
You saw Bexford walking off, and there he goes. Dave, I think I've discovered the secret to kicking longevity. Don't make any tackles on the kickoff team.
Well, some of the great tacklers I've ever seen were on that. Remember Garo Yepremian?
Oh, yeah. Not much of a passer, though.
Boy, could he really stick him on coverage.
So the Commodores will have it at their own 34. Philip Fulmer. And his defense dominating. Offense has been a quick strike bunch today. Ronnie Gordon's missed his last five passes for Vanderbilt. This is a team that's not that good at coming from behind throwing the ball. Option left to the short side of the field. Nothing there.
Boy, and Tennessee does just a marvelous job stringing that along the line. Just keep on stringing along. And then the quarterback going into the short side of the field has nowhere to go.
Tyrone Hines and Terry Fair, middle linebacker, right corner, respectively. And with the ever-present number 90, Ben Talley. It'll be a loss of three. Has to be terribly disappointing for Jerry DiNardo. I don't know if he realistically expected to come in here and whip Tennessee, but he certainly thought it would be more competitive than this. Second and 13 with three wide receivers. Gordon with a lot of time. Nobody open, but he'll run it. And he's met by Tyrone Hines. And you can hear the crowd go, ooh, when that play ended. And it looks like there's an offensive lineman down. Looks like Owen Tank Neal is hurt. By the way, we asked that trivia question a few plays ago. Tennessee's touchdown got in the way of our answer. The only team in the top five in the preseason poll that is still there, you know it.
Florida.
Florida Gators.
All right. I knew one of them. I knew Michigan wasn't. Well, why don't you tell who the other four were?
Well, the preseason top five was Florida, Notre Dame, Florida State, Nebraska, and Michigan. And I do take that back. Nebraska is also there. So there's two of them.
What was Tennessee picked preseason?
They were picked 13th. Let's see if we can find out what happened to Tank Neal here.
He just kind of gets run up in a pile there, I think. On the right of your screen.
He's only a junior. He's had a great career here. Out of DeSales High School in Louisville. Well, you hate to see that. Looks like that right knee. The announcers for this game are selected and compensated by Jefferson Pilot Sports. This broadcast is a copyright presentation. Any use of this broadcast without the express permission of the Southeastern Conference and Jefferson Pilot Sports is prohibited. Bob Carpenter with Bob Kessling down on the sidelines. Dave Rowe upstairs here. 6:22 to go before halftime. Mike Jones, a junior, who backs up Owen Neal, is into the game at 2:62, 2:60. Third and five for the Commodores. Gordon with a deep drop. And the ball looks like it was tipped on the way to Lewis and then picked off down around the 42-yard line. And it was Deron Jenkins waiting there. Those are the kind you love. They just sort of find you when you're in the secondary.
Yeah, not really into coverage. Watch the ball get tipped. I think he got tipped by the receiver. Puts the hands up. Now the ball's up. Look how quickly the corner comes up there. Bang, reacts right to the football. Comes off his coverage, and he gets it again. The ball thrown over his head. He tips it right there, keeps it alive, and the defender comes right up and grabs it.
Well, Deron Jenkins had to wait a long time for his first pick of the year, but that's the eighth of his Tennessee career. Play action. Peyton Manning is in there back again at quarterback. He's got it out to the left side.
Boy, this is just pitch and catch. Run, 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 pitch and catch. Run, 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 pitch and catch.
That's the freshman Andy McCullough on the receiving end there. First appearance by him today and his first reception.
I think you can keep both quarterbacks happy. You can give them a little bit of playing time, and they're doing that.
When are they again going to lose a football game in the month of November? 36-1 the last 9 years.
And that one loss was to Notre Dame. Weren't they number one ranked when they lost?
Yes, they were. There's Stewart. Big opening left side. He smells the end zone, and he's still on his feet down near the five.
James Stewart.
He says, I wanted that one.
Gosh, and he almost had it. He made three outstanding moves. He just froze the defenders right in their socks. I mean, they just were frozen in the field. Watch this move. Going to go strong side now. You see that backside hole open up. Now watch right here. Set him up, come inside to one defender. There's another one. Whoop, he's frozen too. I run right on by him. Now a third one. Wow, that's marvelous running.
First and goal from the six, they'll call it. And the pitch to Stewart. Right side, waiting to feel his way in there. And Collins will keep him out of the end zone. Dan Anderson had the first shot at him, and then Gerald Collins wrapped him up.
That was a good play by Collins. Slide along the line. Don't let him get outside. If you're going to do something right, don't allow him to score. Watch Collins in here. 40. Slide, slide, slide. Don't overrun it. Now accelerate to the outside. Wrap those big arms around him and drive him out of bounds.
Gain of two. Second and goal from the four. 5:07 to go. Second quarter. Stewart. And that time, James Manley collapses on him from behind.
James Manley making the tackle.
No wonder if John Becksport's getting a little bit nervous.
Yeah, the next PAT would be the one to tie the all-time NCAA record for consecutive points after.
Lost one on the play, third down five.
Third and goal from the five. They actually lost a yard on that play.
Well, they ran that reverse one time down here. That worked very well for them.
Two men out to the left. Single back is Stewart. Quickly Manning to the left side. And the ball is picked off near the goal line. It is Anthony Asma. And then he's tackled for a safety. He tried to run it out, and they got him for 2 points.
Oh, mercy. Look at Jerry DiNardo. What in the world else can happen to us? He's ready to take off his headset and just says, hey, listen, I don't want to talk anymore upstairs. I'm going to talk to this young man who makes an outstanding play. Looks the quarterback in. He gets a good interception right here. Now, just go down with it. Watch Ratliff come in here. Ratliff says, I'm going to get a tackle. And he did. Just amazing. Just go down with it.
Now Vanderbilt has to kick the football away.
What that is, that's Azama. He's a freshman. He's made a mistake. You saw an interesting thing there by Jerry DiNardo. He took his headset off. He walked the length of the field down there to talk to his young player. Azama, of course, only a freshman, one of those freshmen that are starting back there. And he said, hey, listen, you made a great play, but you got to remember to keep your composure, to keep your just your presence of the game. In that situation, you're not going to run it back 110 yards. You got to go down with the football.
30-0, Tennessee. They'll get the football back.
John Bexford says, hey, I was supposed to have a chance on that one.
No points after safeties. You got plenty of time today, buddy.
Yes,
not even halftime.
Well, it's just been a disaster for Vanderbilt. Nothing that they had planned has gone right. They fumbled. When they fumble, they've lost the football. They've dropped snaps. They've dropped catches. When Tennessee has fumbled, they fumbled them out of bounds for positive yardage.
Baron Angel chooses the punt instead of off the tee. Ball taken at the 24-yard line by Nilo Sylvan. And he's across midfield. What a second half of the season he's had returning the football. Eric Vance, and I often wonder why they choose to punt the ball. It hangs up a little longer, but they never get nearly the distance as they do kicking the ball off the tee.
Yeah. One of the things I think that makes Sylvan so good at returning kicks is that he immediately makes a little tiny, just a little juke fake step, and then boom, he explodes up through the seam. Of course, you have to give a lot of credit to those blockers opening up that hole, but he just explodes. He tries to get positive yardage. He's not trying to run wide to set up a wall of blockers.
Chester Ford, Aaron Hayden in the game as backs for Tennessee. Manning with a little quick one out to the right side. Joey Kent.
Peyton Manning's pass to Joey Kent.
Corey Chavis takes him out of bounds with his fifth tackle of the day.
Corey Chavis makes
it. Tennessee looking very relaxed, very businesslike at the moment, leading by 30. Clock under 4 minutes to go, and it's only the second quarter.
Boy, when you have two quarterbacks like Manning and, of course, Stewart, two freshman quarterbacks who just a few months ago were sitting in high school, and they're playing as well as they are, I'd be relaxed also.
Second and one. Play action to Hayden. Manning. And that ball was almost picked off after glancing off the hands of Aaron Hayden.
Manning that time getting good protection by that line. You know, that offensive line, that's one of the real keys to Tennessee's success. Got a lot of experience. They take great pride in their play. They love to get out there and run the football. I'll bet every one of them woke up this morning and said, ooh, rain, we're going to get to run the football today.
Yeah, the big fella's up front like that. And a third and one coming up with a single back. And the give is to Hayden. He's got the first down and more. Barrels right over the top of his blocking receiver, Marcus Nash. Down inside the 25-yard line of Vanderbilt.
Boy, when you lose that containment and you can make that corner, that little point, and you've got a running back like Hayden that's got that excellent vision. And boy, that's the mark of a great running back.
Aaron Hayden, 52 yards on the day. He's about halfway to that mark of Charlie Garner. By the way, Brent Gibson giving Jeff Smith some breathing time in that Tennessee offensive line. First down at the 24. Manning on the run. And the ball hit the back of Matt Anderson, who was guarding Marcus Nash. Neither the receiver nor the safety looked for the football until it was too late.
Gibson's a youngster. They're probably saying, hey, what's he doing out here? He's just a youngster. But he's a good football player. Once the receiver just loses the football, he turns around. It actually hits the defender right in the back.
Marcus Nash thought that ball was going to the middle. He turned left, and then he had to turn back, and by that time, too late. Second and 10 at the 24. 3:04 remaining. Aiden broke one tackle. He got away from James Manley, but then Anthony Jordan, who's been a big play man as a nickelback for Vandy, came to get him.
Well, when he looked up, Manley was in the backfield. I bet that was a surprise. Oh, Philip Fulmer. Boy, has he done a marvelous job since he took over here.
Well, I asked him last week, what have you learned about your football team with all the early season adversity? And they lost to UCLA, Florida, Mississippi State early. He said, we learned that we can fight back. That'll really stand us in good stead for 1995. Third and 6, 4 wide receivers. From the shotgun, Manning up top, and the ball is caught by Nilo Sylvan for a touchdown. That's his second TD of the day. His second receiving score of the season. And the route is on big time. It's now 36-0, and John Bexford is about to come out and attempt to tie an NCAA record. This point after, if he knocks it through, would tie him with Carlos Huerta of Miami with 157 in a row. The snapper is Mark Holland. The holder is Lance Wheaton. And they all do their jobs beautifully. 157 in a row.
Give a lot of credit to Wheaton. The backup quarterback doesn't get a chance to play a whole lot, but does a marvelous job holding that football.
But one more to have the record outright.
Well, I think he may get another chance if this offense stays out there. Unbelievable. Needed 12 kicks going into last week's game. And in less than a game and a half, he's gotten to 12 kicks. This is the touchdown play. When you gamble on that blitz and you don't get there, all those receivers are one-on-one. And it's just a perfect pass. You can't throw the football any better than that. Watch Manning, deep set here, never takes his eyes off his receiver, throws it with a lot of height to allow his receiver to run in underneath it, and Sylvan does the job.
Nilo's second receiving touchdown of the year, and a full menu coming up at halftime. What do you have for us, Bob Kessler?
Check back on some of the great plays and the great moments so far during this SEC season. We'll also take a look at the scholar athletes from around the conference. There are some outstanding student athletes. Also, our SEC Player of the Week, a member of the Western Division champion Alabama Crimson Tide, and check on scores from all across the country. That's coming up at halftime in just a few moments.
Sort of an abbreviated schedule here late in November. On the college football front, 20-yard pass to Nilo Sylvan, and it's 37-0 Tennessee. That ball bombed right through the end zone.
I think that thing was carried by the wind, but it wasn't. The wind is dead calm.
The ball is jumping off John Bexford's boot right now. 2:17 to go before halftime. Just a terribly disappointing day for Vanderbilt so far. They thought they had a chance to win this game. They are getting blown out. Bexford has a chance to grab the Tennessee record with his next field goal or a couple of points after. But I don't think he'll set the SEC record of Kevin Butler. A ways to go for that one. Ronnie Gordon, and he's taken down behind the line. Looked like Steve White, the right end, got to him. That would be his 8th sack of the year.
Oh, everybody got to him. You see Ben Talley there also. It was Steve White and Ben Talley. They kind of met at the crossroads.
Okay, we'll each give him a half. That'll be 7 for White and 6 for Talley.
Well, now I'll tell you, if you're a defensive lineman, this is fun time. Because you don't have to really worry about the running plays. You just come off. You get that third down and long yardage, you're going to come off the football. But that's been the story of this game. Vanderbilt has never been in that situation, third down and 2 or 3 yards.
Little screenplay set up. Eric Lewis breaks one tackle of Tyrone Hines. I think it's a couple of more yards, but good Tennessee pursuit.
when you go down, you go back and think of plays. I think of that play when they went out of bounds when Gerald Collins had that personal foul on the quarterback out of bounds. Would that have changed maybe the complexion? You're looking for a lot of things right now if you're on the Vanderbilt side, a lot of plus things.
Tennessee has called a timeout with a minute 29 remaining.
And that's a good call. Third down, you've got a chance to get the football back. Coaches play full out for a halftime. It doesn't make a difference what the score is.
But in the second half, that would be a no-no?
Well, in the second half, with a score like this, yes, that would be a no-no. But in this situation, you're still in the first half of football. You've got a chance. It's third down. It's going to be third and seven, a sure passing situation. Quarterback's not had a lot of success on passing. If you're going to get the football back, try it one more time.
Well, next week is the SEC championship game in Atlanta with Florida and Bama getting together. And, of course, at the World Congress Center next to the Georgia Dome, there will be a whole myriad of activities put on by the SEC. Hope you can join them for the fanfare. It'll be a lot of fun. You can call the 1-800 number for tickets. And there will be some of the all-time SEC greats from all the SEC schools representing Vanderbilt will be Bill Wade. Bob Johnson will be there representing Tennessee. And some other greats will be there as well. On third and a long six, a screen to Lewis. Ooh, upended at the 25. And the Commodores will be well short.
See if they use another timeout now again to stop the clock.
They will.
Going to be a punt situation. Well, you talk about some of those legends. There are going to be some tremendous players at that fanfare. I know Jim Taylor is going to be there.
Tyrone Hines might be a legend someday, Bob Kessling.
It's an interesting story about Tyrone. He was the defensive end coming out of high school. In fact, didn't think he was even going to play linebacker at Tennessee. Then they put him in the middle, and everything seemed to gel. One thing Vanderbilt wanted to do today was to try and get Tyrone Hines off the line of scrimmage a little bit, since he's such an aggressive linebacker. But without the threat, really, of Vanderbilt throwing the football, the Tennessee linebackers have been able to stay close to the line of scrimmage, and I think that has been a big key. So they're trying to get the early in his career, they said that Tyrone really didn't understand the pass coverages since he was a defensive end. But as you can see today, the rest of the linebackers and Tyrone Hines have made some adjustments and have just made life miserable for this Vanderbilt offense.
Well, Tyrone was sort of miserable, didn't get to play for 2 years. Academically ineligible, 92, redshirted last year, but he was ready this time. Now the Volunteers will have the ball back with one timeout remaining.
Oh, and they got 9 or 10 up on the line. Now they drop a couple back looking for the return.
Barrett Angel with a low spiral. This is definitely returnable, but the ball dives into the turf on Nilo Sylvan. And instead of chancing a fumble, he decided to let the ball dive right down. And the Vols will be back at their own 28.
Well, we've played multiple quarterbacks. Who's going to quarterback this series?
Looks like Brandon Stewart is headed out there.
Yeah, in talking with those coaches, a lot of talk has been about Brandon Stewart because he is such a tremendous talent. Very, very gifted athletically, because the talk is that he might not want to stay behind Peyton Manning. But you can keep two quarterbacks happy right now. You're giving them both playing time, and they're both having success like they are.
Stewart and Hayden are the running backs in there. 104 remaining. Stewart out to the near side. Nilo Sylvan up in the air, then shoved out by Matt Anderson. Out around the 30-yard line for a gain of just a couple.
Knocked out of bounds by Matt Anderson.
When you have Sylvan speed, you remember that old out and up when they'd say out and just keep on going out, and also when the defender comes up, you turn it up and you throw that bomb. That's the kind of speed that Nilo Sylvan has.
He had three catches, 24 yards against the Wildcats of Kentucky last week. Second down and eight at the 30, and a draw play for Hayden. Collins was waiting for him. Arden got away from him, and then Brian Boykin stayed with him to make the tackle.
Bobby, you talk about this offensive line, and we've excelled about their excellence all day long. They only lose one of them. Just Mays, I think, is the only one that's is a senior.
Kevin Mays at left guard. And another running play. Hayden for the first down out to midfield. They've got 30 seconds left and a timeout. The clock will stop here while they move the chains. John Becksport doesn't have tremendous range. His longest field goal of the year is only 44 yards.
Collins makes the tackle.
And a timeout.
And a player injured. That may be Hayden on the field.
That is.
Where the trainer put his hand down on his right ankle. Let's see if we can see this. Maybe watch his right ankle. See if, in fact, he doesn't get fallen on there. There's the right ankle underneath the body of the defender. It's Gerald Collins. That's quite a body.
They're going to cut the tape off. Bad news for Vanderbilt as the Tank Neal is headed for the locker room with that right knee heavily taped and iced.
Well, interesting. A lot of times in this situation, when you've got an ankle injury, of course, there are medical people there. What you do is you tighten the shoe and actually try to keep the swelling down. They've elected they're going to cut it off to examine it and then try to tape it right back up if, in fact, it doesn't have anything serious with it.
Well, coming into the game, Aaron needed 106 yards to pass Charlie Garner, all time on the Tennessee rushing list. He's about halfway there, but he may not be able to go the rest of the day. 78 yards, his totals.
And Bob, I think someone just told me in my ear that it's a break above the ankle, they're saying, a possible break above the ankle. That would just
We want to tell you before we show you this replay, if you remember the injury several years ago to Joe Theismann, if you don't like watching this sort of thing, turn away from your television while we show you the replay of what happened to Aaron Hayden.
Yeah, it's Gerald Collins is number 40. Now, this is totally an accidental thing. Now, watch, when he plants right here, you're going to see Collins come in. And as he falls on his ankle. The weight of Collins, he's 250 pounds. And you see his ankle. They're saying a break above the ankle.
That's a bad one. And that's why the entire medical personnel of Tennessee is out there.
Boy, such a marvelous player. I mean, a real team player, a real battle this year, but it was a friendly battle between James Stewart and Aaron Hayden for playing time. Remember last week we were talking about all the two stats that they had. They were only like two carries apart all year. Just marvelous football players.
Donnie Reeves, please report to Palmer Fieldhouse. The red roof building.
30 seconds remaining in the first half. Crowd is very quiet. Volunteers to a man have to know that Aaron Hayden is done for this game and any bowl game the Volunteers might be playing in. And nobody feels it worse than Aaron Hayden's best friend, James Stewart. That's kind of like twin brothers hurting for each other right there.
It sure is. And I'll tell you this, on the Vanderbilt side of the field, you can see their players all standing around too because, again, you don't want to see this happen to anyone, regardless of which team they're on.
Bob Kessling downstairs.
You know, Aaron Hayden, it's been a really remarkable story. He came down to Tennessee from Detroit, Michigan, and really as a freshman, he and James Littleman Stewart played in the first game that year against Louisville, and Hayden had an outstanding game, scored a touchdown against the Cardinal. And then in one of the biggest games in Tennessee history, when the Volunteers came in that dramatic comeback against Notre Dame, when Hayden was a freshman and they came back from a 31-7 down to win, Hayden scored what proved to be the go-ahead touchdown. Then he slumped a little bit, and then I guess a sophomore slump. Then last year he was off to a good start and got hurt in the LSU game, and then he missed about the second half of the season. Hayden is in a situation too where a couple of times with Charlie Garner coming in, and then he was playing behind James Littleman Stewart, the third team tailback. He had thought about maybe leaving school a couple of times and going back or transferring, but Philip Fulmer always got with him and told him, if you stay here, you'll get a chance to play. And so Hayden decided to stay, and as it's turned out extremely well. And Hayden said one of the reasons he stayed is the fact that Coach Fulmer never lied to him. He said everything Coach Fulmer told him came true. He was going to get a chance to play if he stayed, and indeed he did that. And so now Aaron Hayden lays on the turf here at Vanderbilt. A tough way to end his senior season and apparently his last game for the Volunteers.
On Johnny Major's staff, Philip Fulmer recruited Aaron Hayden out of Mumford High School in Detroit. It's been very close to him. Bob mentioned some of the adversity and young guys like Hayden and Stewart, who are such stars in high school. James, of course, out of Morristown, Tennessee, West High School. They were used to being the stars. And all of a sudden, this guy from junior college, Charlie Garner, showed up, and they were both put into the background. Jerry DiNardo certainly knows that something very serious has happened out there.
And Bob, one of the things that they're trying to do with the medical team is immediately they come out and try to relax the player. I've been in that situation. I know what it's like. They come out, they try to relax you, let you get your breath back. They tell you that you're hurt. And then what they do is they start to totally immobilize the injured area. They may put an air cast on it. They may tape it. You see the reactions of the Vanderbilt players. They're down, of course, because of the game. But also, I looked across the field and I saw Gerald Collins walk all the way over to the huddle there, where they're all gathered around, and kind of bent down and told him he was sorry. I mean, it's just purely an accident. But right now, try to immobilize it, get it as still as possible. They brought a cart out on the field where they're going to be able to transport him off the field onto a little cart. What's amazing is the number of times that you get hit, and you don't get hit like that. You're just not prepared for a hit like that. You get hit in the front, you've got shoulder pads on, a face mask, a helmet, thigh pads, knee pads, things like that, but you never plan on getting hit from the side. You see the straps there, that's to totally immobilize him so he doesn't move it and do any more damage to the injured area.
He will come up 28 yards short of catching Charlie Garner on the Tennessee rushing chart. But that's not the concern now. The concern now is getting him healed. Aaron Hayden closes out a great career. Played only 7 games last year because of a knee problem. 1,242 yards his first 3 years. And he'll add over 800 yards to that as a senior. And we bid him a very fond farewell.
The Tennessee team, you hate to talk about emotion. They've got a comfortable lead in this football game, but those players have just watched their star player, a colleague, go off the field. Now they need to get back into the action, play, get their emotions back settled down, and start playing their offense again. And you see they jump off sides right away. That's what happens.
Kevin Mays, the left guard, one of the emotional leaders of this team, was one of the first men to pop up.
Before the ball was snapped, movement by the offense. 5 yards, still first down.
Well, it's kind of like the horse, the man who gets thrown from the horse. You want to get right back on the horse and start riding. And that's what they need to do with their team, is get them right back on, let them run a few running plays, get a few hits, get back into the field of the game, and continue this game.
First and 15. Stewart to Mose Phillips. Good yardage up the middle. Manley got him from behind. And then some help from Mark Jepko. Now the Volunteers still have a timeout. That was an official's timeout, evidently, when the injury occurred. Scoreboard still says one timeout remaining, but looks like Tennessee is going to just walk off here.
Yeah, they looked over to Phil Fulmer, and he said just let the clock run down. I think his emotions obviously are in the locker room, too, with Aaron Hayden.
37-0 Tennessee at the half. They handled Vandy 62-14 in Knoxville a year ago. It's been 1982 since Vandy last won a game in the series. Let's check in downstairs.
Yeah, really, when the score is like this, I think it's important that we play hard the second half. That's what we're going to tell them, and we're going to get going.
Your team's just been overwhelmed, though, today.
Yeah, we really have. We haven't played very well. They haven't punted yet. Our defense hasn't slowed them down, and we got to move the ball offensively. But we're going to go in there. We're going to regroup, and our kids are going to fight the second half.
Thanks, Coach Jerry DiNardo, going to the locker room. Tennessee with a lopsided halftime advantage. Back with our halftime activities from Vanderbilt in just a moment.
Welcome back to Nashville, Tennessee, Vanderbilt Stadium, Dudley Field. Total domination by the visitors. Phillip Fulmer's Tennessee Volunteers looking to go 7-4. And the coach told us it looks good as he talked to Bob Kessler.
Phillip, dominating first half for your team.
Well, obviously really pleased with our players. I'm really sad for Aaron Hayden. That's just such a sad thing. Looks like he's got a broken leg. But our team has played well. We've made some plays in the passing game, loosened them back up. Ran the football well, and we need to continue and have a good second half.
I mean, you came out and jumped on them.
Our team was ready to play. Our football team has played better the last 7 weeks or so, and I think this is culminating a good. We've got another half to play good.
Thanks, Phillip. Okay.
Play good. Boy, have they.
Play good?
Look at their possessions. They've scored almost every time. Even when they gave up an INT, they got a safety. And they should have really scored on the missed field goal. So they've been nearly flawless today. They've averaged almost 9 yards a play, 8.9 yards every time they snap the football.
And they have not punted in the first half. So that tells you, as Jerry DiNardo said, we haven't slowed them down all day.
And here's Steve Yenner, the Vanderbilt kicker.
Steve Yenner set to kick off for Vanderbilt.
And the ball will come down short at about the 9. Nilo Sylvan up the middle. Breaks a couple of tackles. Still on his feet. Black flies as he surpasses the 40-yard line. He'll get 31 yards, maybe even a yard more on that return. Nilo's really looked dangerous returning punts.
Holding on the run back by the offense. 10 yards from the spot. First down.
And kickoffs, Lindley. Now let's check where the spot of the foul was. It goes 10 yards back from that.
It looked like about the 36-yard line.
Nate Manning sharing first half playing time with Brandon Stewart. And for you statistical nuts, in the first half, Stewart was 5 for 5 for 98 yards. There's James Stewart. What a big first half he had with 108 yards. I expect that he'll play for a while here.
Bob, you talked about domination on that first down play. You see him moving the sticks. One play, move the sticks. One play, move the sticks.
How about the matchup with Gerald Collins and Kevin Mays?
That's a good hit by both of them.
Well,
it's really got to be disappointing for Gerald Collins. He came back with the idea he wanted to play well in this game. They came in enthused, and all of a sudden, everything went wrong for him.
Three tacklers on that play, and a flag flies.
Mark Jeffcoat on the tackle. Flag on the play.
I think it's going to be holding against Tennessee. Preliminary call indicated that. Gosh, another player down.
One other thing we need to tell you about the season of James Stewart. He came in with 907 yards, and obviously going over 100, he's over the 1,000-yard mark for the 94 season.
By the offense, 10 yards from the spot, second down.
Is that Stewart down?
Well, I saw a 3. Yeah, that's 33.
Oh, boy, you don't need to lose another one.
Fracking first down.
Tailback combination of Stewart and Hayden had 1,649 yards coming into this game today. We're going to add about another 200 on there. He's got 125 now. Aaron Hayden went out injured with 70 plus, 77 officially. Unfortunately, the little man looks okay.
First and 10, rather, first and
24. I thought I saw Bob Kessler in one of those hats down there on the sideline just before it stopped raining.
That would look like the Great Pumpkin. First down at the 29. Less than a minute into the third quarter. Play action, and Manning rolls to the left, throws across his body. What a throw! Marcus Nash on the catch into Vanderbilt territory. That was some throw by Peyton Manning, who was sprinting full speed to his left and actually had to throw the ball sort of lagging it back behind.
Well, you grow with experience, and this is experience. You'll see he checks off his primary receiver and sees coming across the field, he sees his secondary receiver. That's just a great adjustment. Picks up another one of those moving to state players.
That's a freshman, folks, 6'5". He can see over defenses. Marcus Nash with a good day, true freshman. 5 catches on the year now, with 2 of them coming here. Jay Graham is in the backfield. He does a little counter and then gets outside to the left, and that's a first down for the Volunteers. He's psyched. Jay Graham is a sophomore out of Kannapolis, North Carolina. He's carried the ball 46 times now. And he's a guy who will be around for a while. He'll step into a big role with Stewart and Hayden both departed next year. Ronnie Pillow, a redshirt freshman out of Columbia, Tennessee, is 4th on that depth chart.
I think that's the 4th play on first down that they've made another first down. I think that's the 4th first down in a row.
Well, when you're averaging 9 yards a play, Manning on the run, and a little too tall for Marcus Nash, his 6'3 freshman receiver. John Bexford has something on his mind. The next point after would give him the all-time NCAA consecutive PAT record. It would be 158. It's 5 for 5 today.
I thought it was interesting what Jerry DiNardo said going into the locker room at halftime. He said, hey, we've just gotten manhandled in this first half. We're going to come out and play hard football. I would look for them to come and play hard football in the second half.
Graham. was a pretty good stick.
It sure was.
He was met head on there inside the 30-yard line. Then he just kept on going. Looks like it was Kirk Williams, number 46.
Well, this is what you call a decleater on both sides. I mean, face on face. This is what you got to do. You want to play? This is what it looks like from a linebacker spot. Cut back against the grain. Watch this. Face mask to face mask. Receiver, the running back wins on that one. Graham wins.
Yeah, he's 6 foot 206. Williams is 6 foot 228. Tennessee's been great on third down today. And they've got another one.
Jay Graham on the carry.
Jay Graham again.
Jay Sallworth. Sheffield in on the tackle.
You say they've been great on third down. They've been great on every down. Watch the hole to the left of your screen right here open up. Kick him inside. You see they kick the linebacker outside. He just breaks a couple tackles, falls forward. For that first down, they've been great on every down.
First down at the 22. Three wide receivers, a man in the slot, and a single back. Graham has it again. Big room up the middle. And riding hurt on him for quite a while was Anthony Jordan before they could bring him down. And that's another Tennessee first down. It's just really all coming apart here for Vanderbilt right out of the locker room.
Let's just push the left, find a hole, find the seam, get those speed up there. Defensive backs are coming up.
Graham has 40 yards rushing already on this drive. First down at the 11. Again. And not this time. James Manley, the first man there. And then Jay Stallworth, the left defensive end, finished him off.
Jay Stallworth in on the tackle.
P-A-T. P-A-T.
One plus.
Something about those guys in orange. Huerta from Miami. Exford from Tennessee.
You realize how many touchdowns you have to score? That's a lot of touchdowns.
You also have to kick a lot as a freshman. That's a four-year thing. Play action. Manning on a bootleg. Got away from one would-be tackler. And he throws it down to the three-yard line, complete to Kendrick Jones.
Boy, you talk about on the run, Manning. We saw him go to the left one time and throw just perfectly. This time he comes to the right. He's under a lot of pressure there. Anthony Jordan, safety's going to come in there. Just fakes around him. Now on the run, crossed his body, bam. Just throws it about a yard inbounds, feet down.
Boy, we've seen some great plays from this young quarterback on this drive.
Watch Kendrick Jones get that foot down and bounce. Just concentrate, that little stutter step.
It'll be third and two from the three. Actually, the first down yardage is the half-yard line. Graham, the man they faked to. He could have run in, but it's a touchdown pass. And it's David Horn, the tight end. Manning could have walked the ball into the end zone, but he went for the TD pass.
Well, what he did is when he faked the ball and he came out on the boot all by himself, he froze the corner. Here comes Mr. Bexport.
David Horn with his second touchdown catch of the year, and Bexport for the all-time NCAA consecutive PAT record. And arms are raised on the Tennessee sideline. John Bexford is now the pacemaker as he surpasses Miami's Carlos Huerta. And it's Tennessee 44-0 with 11:18 to go in the third quarter. 44-0 Tennessee. Less than 4 minutes into the second half. John Bexford gets to kick off a lot too, doesn't he? Takes it to the near side of the 10-yard line. Bobby Jackson on the return for Vandy. There's a flag as he cuts it inside and gets out to the far hash around the 26-yard line. Craig King on the stop. Bobby Jackson with his sixth kickoff return of the year. And the flag would sort of indicate that Vandy will start even deeper.
Yeah, that's usually from that angle, it's almost always that block in the back. We've seen that so many times.
On the run back, block in the back, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Boy, it's been a day for that young man. He has had nothing go right. They couldn't come out and establish the run, put pressure on the passer. He's just been under it all day long.
A lot of Tennessee fans down in that end zone making noise for their defense. Commodores are first down at their own 10. Option right. Gordon looking to keep, but a flag had been flown and a whistle blown before the play. Looks like Robert Couch, the left tackle, raised up.
Yeah, anytime an offensive lineman's offsides, that's illegal motion, so the play stops.
Before the ball was snapped, movement by the offense, 5 yards, still first down.
Vanderbilt, a big zero in the first half, punting their first five times and then their last time after having a pass picked off.
When you look at the length of their drives, four plays, five plays, six, six. Their longest drive has been seven plays.
And this is an offense that lives on ball control. First and 15 at the five. And this time it looks like Alan DeGroffenried raised up. So whoever they put at left tackle comes up out of his stance. First Couch and then his backup.
Bob, you talked about the crowd. There's a lot of orange down in that end zone there. I wonder if they're messing up the snap count because they're pretty vocal here.
Well, they're going to say this one was against Tennessee.
Wow, that's an interesting one.
Well, there must have been encroachment first and some contact made. But look at where they huddle up.
I know. They huddle right next to the ball. It's almost as if they want Tennessee to hear what they say.
First down as the ball goes back to the 10. Gordon gives it to Jermaine Johnson, the tailback. And what a quiet day he has had.
Well, that's the truth. Coming in with 859 yards, he's been an excellent running back. Got great acceleration and speed, and just has not been a factor today.
You can only add 13 onto that total. He came in number five in the SEC in rushing, averaging 86 yards a game.
Look how close they huddle to the ball. About a yard. All they do is they just turn around and get down.
One of their few good first down plays today leaves them with a second and three. Option right. Gordon cuts it inside on Ben Talley. And he'll be a little bit short. Third down play coming up. Let's check in with Bob Kessling.
Yesterday we talked with Jerry Donato, the Vanderbilt coach. He told us last year his team took a big step backwards when they lost to Tennessee 62-14. He thought his team was really ready to play last year, and they played horribly. He thought today was a chance for his Vanderbilt team to step up and make a big step forward. Well, it's not happened again, so I guess the question on this Vanderbilt sideline, just exactly how devastating will this game be to Vanderbilt and their confidence and psyche of rebuilding this program. We can tell you one good thing, though. Owen Neal, the Vanderbilt tackle who was taken to the locker room right before halftime, the injury's not as bad as he once feared. It's apparently just a sprained ankle. And now, of course, Tennessee, or sprained knee, I should say. And, of course, Tennessee now concerned about Ben Talley, who was down on the field.
And up. Hate to see guys get hurt in a 44-0 game if you're Tennessee with another game to play sometime in the next month or so. And by the way, speaking of bowl games, Vanderbilt had bowl hopes today. Their last bowl game was the 82 Hall of Fame when they lost to Air Force.
See the leg kind of get folded back in that pile.
And ironically for Vanderbilt, they had hoped to win here today and then have Air Force lose next week at Hawaii and thought they might have a shot at the Independence Bowl. But it all becomes moot when you're down 44-0. Look at the twisting and turning of Eric Lewis for a first down up to about the 28-yard line. Jason Parker, we haven't heard much about Jason today. That's because nobody's made it through to the secondary.
That's right. Parker gets him. He's the safety, the free safety. He stands back there, and when the person blocked pops through the secondary into the secondary, he's the one to make so many tackles. Last week he had 10.
Yeah. They expected him to be very physical, involved in the option today, but the Vanderbilt option has very seldom ever gotten to the Tennessee secondary. First down at the 28. Gordon with play action and a look to the far side. Standing out there is Gabe Banks with an inside move that gets him a first down. And then he's out of bounds at the 38-yard line.
Well, Bob, you start talking about Vanderbilt, and you think of, as Bob Kessling said, a devastating loss. How does it hurt their program? But when you look at the number of players that they have on defense that they're going to come, that are going to come back, they had 18 of the 22 two-deep starters are freshmen and sophomores. They're going to be back for a long time, so they've got a lot of promise coming back on defense.
That was Gabe's first catch of the day. Junior out of Delaware, Ohio. First and 10 at the 39. Option left. He ran into his fullback, and that messed up the play. And then Leland Taylor caught up with him. You lose a little bit of speed when you run into your fullback on the option.
Well, and that shows you what kind of team speed you have when defensive linemen are running down quarterbacks from the backside. Taylor's number 57. He's on the backside. He catches the quarterback on the back.
Leland had to sit out the first half for fighting against those Wildcats last week. So he's in there ready to get in a few licks.
I thought that was an interesting comment. Philip Fulmer's very much for that rule. He said it really gets the players' attention.
Now, what if you get thrown out the last game of the season? Do you have to sit out the first half of the spring game?
Well, you don't have to sit out any if you're a senior.
Gordon up over the top, and the ball was nearly intercepted back at the 40-yard line by Deron Jenkins. He got his first of the season earlier today, and he was sniffing out another one right there.
I thought Jenkins had this ball all the way. He's a top cornerback on this little stop and hitch. Now when he comes up, the ball's going to go right between his hands. Watch this. Oh, does he miss an easy one? Look at him. You can always tell those defensive backs. They kind of walk away. Oh, man, I had one. He just kind of wants to stand out there by himself. He doesn't want anybody looking at him. He knows he missed it.
Out of St. Louis, Rittner High School, Deron Jenkins, a junior. They're down and 12 now for the Commodores. Four wide receivers. Gordon looking right all the way. Leland Taylor missed him. So he will keep it, get the first down, out to midfield. There aren't too many quarterbacks in the country that could get a first down on a play like that. Ronnie Gordon's shaken up a bit.
Boy, and then you start looking who's behind Ronnie Gordon. You only have Damian Allen. He's only thrown one pass.
He's a true freshman, and so is Jeremy Wills, who has not played at all.
Again, watch Gordon scramble up through the line, trying to find that yardage. Pocket collapses around him, the backside pressure. Now just kind of squirt up through there. Now get the first down yardage and get down. Looks as if he might have fallen on the football.
Take the wind out of you.
Now he's back down. He's kneeling back down. Whoa. Again.
See Jason Parker come flying in there.
Yeah.
Is that a 7 on his back or an S on his chest? The way he came flying into the frame.
Well, sometimes when you fall on that football, it just kind of knocks the wind out of you real quick, and I think that's what's happened with Gordon.
Well, Ronnie Gordon, they had a tough second half at Arkansas when they lost 42-6. It was a lot like this, and Jerry DiNardo said, when we were down big at halftime, we made a very useful approach to that second half. We wanted to throw on first down, try a few things, and let Ronnie grow up a little bit. Then they followed, beating Cincinnati on the road by 10, hammering Georgia in Athens in a game we did where they ran for 414 yards, a narrow loss at home to Carolina. They beat Northern Illinois and won at Kentucky before running into the Gators. So the last month and a half has been pretty good for this team. Damian Allen will come in and take the snap.
Boy, you're ice cold and you fumble the football.
Yep, it's on the turf. Johnson had it for a while. Who's going to end up with it? It looks like Scott Galyon of Tennessee might be the man. Three or four touched it, and Tennessee gets the ball back.
Yep, Galyon just dove on that football. That's so hard for a quarterback to come off the bench. He's ice cold. He hasn't thrown the ball. He doesn't even get time to take a snap. Now he makes an indecision play, whether that was misdirection or not. Might have been a reverse coming back around. But again, there's the fumble. Now nobody seems to want to pick up the football. Just fall on it. There's Galyon. He says, I'll fall on it.
He's a big play guy. He's blocked a kick, broken up a couple of passes, intercepted one this year, and that was his fourth fumble recovery of the season. First down at the 33, end around. That's Billy Williams.
The
man, he'll get about 6 or 7 yards. How many times has Billy carried the ball this year? I've got that as the first one. They've used Milo Sylvan in that role 8 times this year, including a touchdown today. Billy has just been banged up all year, had a stress fracture against UCLA in the first play of the season, had a shoulder problem for a while. He's been okay for the last 2 weeks.
I remember last week when I had those friends visit me in the booth. One of those was a lady named Mrs. Ray. Now, she's gone to 40 years of Tennessee football, and she gave me the inside scouting report on Gallion. She said, he's a great kid. He goes to church every Sunday.
Hey, how about Jay Graham here in the second half? And a player down is Jay Stallworth for Vanderbilt in the play. Graham now has played 2 drives in this quarter and has 53 yards rushing.
Gosh, and they just keep on continuing to open holes.
This offensive line doesn't care who's running the football today.
Well, they've made a lot of changes up front. A lot of players are getting play. You saw DeGraffenreid is in there, and you know, other players are getting playing time, but boy, it hasn't changed the scenario up there.
Jay Stallworth, a redshirt freshman from Marshall, Texas. Great speed on that defensive end. He runs a 4.7 40. LSU and Texas A&M recruited him.
Howard, I should give some credit. That's not the gravity. That's 75 for Tennessee. That's Ratliff.
Leslie Ratliff.
Yeah, Ratliff. Boy, he's a good football player. Big, 6'7", about 304, 305 pounds, and he looks thin. At him. He's just a tower out there.
Folks in Arkansas wondering how the Volunteers snuck him out of Newport. Hard to miss. First down at the 14. 7:15 to go, third quarter. Fake pitch and a give to the first man through. And that was Eric Lane, who backs up Mose Phillips at fullback. In fact, Eric is listed third on the depth chart there behind Mose and Chester Ford.
You know, Bob, we talked about the changes on defense that really turned around Tennessee's defense. That change in the center, even though it was pretty slight, where Bubba Miller moved over and Jeff Smith moved up because Bubba Miller, I think he kept a tendon on his finger. Well, that was a big change, too.
Second and 7, Jay Graham again. Takes about 3 or 4 Commodores to bring it down. Gerald Collins, Anthony Asma. Collins has 6 tackles today. Asma has 5. And Jay Graham keeps on running.
There's Boykin in there. He just gets kicked inside. You see the running back go right by him. Now that's responsibility. When you see a lineman come in that hard inside, he's got inside gap responsibility. That's not that he made a mistake. That's just that the running back made the adjustment once he got his gap responsibility.
3rd and 2 from the 6. Graham again, and he cracks down to the 3.5, and that should be enough for a first down.
Well, you have to like the way he runs the football. In tight, in traffic, both hands on the football, protecting it. It's not going to get it punched out. Finds that, that stays up in his stance and rolls around and finds that first down.
Jay Graham, an All-American a couple of years at Concord High School in Kannapolis, North Carolina. And he sets his teammates up for 1st and goal at the 4. Graham has scored 1 touchdown this year. Let's see if he can pop in another one. 2 tight ends and a timeout call. It'll be Vanderbilt stopping the clock. With 5:45 to go, third quarter, they're down by 44 to their arch rivals. And we're back to Nashville after a word from your local SEC station. 3rd and goal for the Volunteers at the 1-yard line of Vanderbilt. They've run a couple of rushing plays and gotten maybe a yard on each play. And it looks like the Commodores will back up half the distance. One of them just jumped off sides.
Before the ball was snapped, contact by the defense, half the distance, still 3rd down.
Boy, you're down there and just seems like everything. It's an avalanche coming down on you. DeGraffenreid down there trying to get that penetration. Just got that penetration 1 sound too early.
3rd and goal from less than the 1. And the first man through is the man who scores. That's Chester Ford. Yes, he says. My first of the year. And it's 50-0.
With Mr. consistent comes on here and kicks another field goal, I mean, another extra point, realize that's 158 points that they've scored in the last four games. Just power football up front.
Bexport for the point after. He wouldn't have a mental lapse and miss one here, would he, now that he's got the record?
Nah, I think I'd put a dollar on that.
Pulled it a bit, but he's got it through. 51-0 Tennessee with 4:06 remaining third quarter. They love it in Nashville, at least the folks in orange do. This telecast is brought to you in part by Hardee's, your tailgating headquarters and a proud sponsor of the SEC. Well, the real Smokey got let go, so there's the other Smokey.
Yeah, they said his, the real Smokey, they said his bite was worse than his bark.
Beckford will kick off for Tennessee.
Well, the Volunteers, the guys between the lines, have had a bark and a bite here today. 51-0. Bobby Jackson on the kickoff return for Vanderbilt.
Talk about a game. I mean, 51-0. That says enough right there, but it hasn't been that close. And that's incredible.
Corey Gaines, the hit on special teams. You know, Tennessee in the NCAA Division I computer rankings this week is number 17 in the country. That, of course, is based on who they play, margin of winning, and things like that. And they're not in the top 25 in the AP poll. They go 7-4 with a huge win here. They've got a chance to crack that top 25 before the bowl season comes in. Ronnie Gordon, by the way, is back in for Vandy. And Jermaine Johnson, with his first big run of the day, gets about 9.5 yards on first down. Second and short coming up. Bob Kessling has more on Aaron Hayden.
Yeah, we talked again with Bill Yeomans, the team doctor, orthopedic surgeon of Tennessee. They say he has a broken tibia and a broken fibula. And so they will take him back to Knoxville. He'll spend the night in the hospital, and then they'll determine whether they can just go ahead and treat the leg or if a surgery of some sort might be necessary. But again, Aaron Hayden, if you weren't with us, apparently he suffered the broken leg in the first half. It's right above the ankle, about 5 inches or so above the ankle.
Ball on the carpet again. Gordon trying to grab it, and it looks like Tennessee has it again. Nick Jester came up to recover the fumble. Nick backs up Scott Galyon at right linebacker, so you know he doesn't get a whole lot of playing time.
This is just a fumble. Quick, go back the other way. Lift the ball. No one even touches him. Tennessee so opportunistic. They've been on everything today. You know, you wonder about how good they are, Bob. I mean, we talked about them scoring 158 points. In the last four ball games, they've only had 35 scored against them.
And the backups are in at offensive line. Brandon Stewart out to the left side. That ball caught by Scott Pfeiffer, the backup tight end. And that's his second catch of the season. He had one for 3 yards against Georgia. Scott's a sophomore out of St. Louis University High School. Only the third catch of his career. And Brandon Stewart goes 6-for-6.
Well, right away you start thinking about what's the highest score that Tennessee has ever scored. They scored 68 points in 1951 against Tennessee Tech. Hopefully we won't see that today.
Stewart with a little delay. And that's Ronnie Pillow. And he will score. A 15-yard run by the fourth-string tailback.
Okay, I take it back. I didn't mean to bring it up this early. Incredible.
With 3:01 remaining in the third quarter, it's 57-0.
Does Bexford have a backup? I mean, in case his leg gets tired.
Jeff,
how many times he's kicked off?
They really don't list one. Jeff Hall, I suppose, a freshman who backs up the punter and the kicker.
Tom Bexford in for the PAT.
Another perfect one, ho-hum. And it's 58-0 Tennessee with 3:01 to go before the fourth quarter.
What's that, 14 touchdowns in the last 2 weeks?
Pretty impressive.
Certainly is. total domination in every phase. Again, this is breaking tackles, good blocks. No one making tackles, arm tackles, no one getting in front of them and just dancing into the end zone.
Ronnie Pillow with his fifth run of the year. And he gets into the end zone for the first time. They're exhausted from doing push-ups after these touchdowns. Championship ice skating coming to Nashville tomorrow. The Music City Invitational. Oksana Bayou, Katarina Witt, five other world champions. Tickets available at the auditorium box office after 2 p.m. tomorrow at the 615 number you see. And then they move on to Memphis Thursday, December 1st, Mid-South Coliseum. First post-Olympic competition for Witt, Bayou, and Kerrigan. Exhibition special by reigning world champion Elvis Stoico. You got to go to Memphis to watch a guy named Elvis skate. The rock and roll figure skating spectacular. 901-525-1515 for tickets. Bobby Jackson on the kickoff return for Vandy. And he again fails to make it to the 20-yard line. Corey Gaines again. Do we give an SEC Special Teams Player of the Week award? He would be a nominee at the moment.
Just incredible. I want to tell you, you know, you said they were tired of doing those push-ups. I watched that Mountaineer guy, and he was doing them. He was on his knees doing them. He wasn't doing a fair push-up, but his arms are probably so tired. Oh, amazing day. Well, it's good to see Ronnie Gordon back in there.
He will look to the right side and throw one to Gabe Banks. Taken out of bounds there by Steve Johnson. Johnson the backup for Deron Jenkins at Tennessee's left corner. Phillip Fulmer getting the play the whole roster today as he leads 58-0. Last 2:36 of the third quarter.
And you know what goes through a coach's mind in this situation is don't get anybody hurt. We've already lost one of our great players. Don't get anyone else hurt. Which quarterback do I use? Which line do I use? Which defensive backs do I use? Do I rest everybody? I think it's time to let some of those other players get a chance to get some playing opportunities in there.
Second down and one. Pretty good stick in there as Eric Lewis went ahead for the first down. There's Brad Holland. He's been snapping for years for John Bexford. Looks like he wants to go in and throw a few.
Taylor. He may get his chance.
Mark Holland out of Sail Creek, Tennessee. Ex-walk-on. A third-year senior. Making those perfect snaps.
Boy, those are great stories. When a young player decides he wants to go to school, it's his dream to go to a school, he walks on the football team. Now, you just don't walk out and say, hey, coach, I want to play. You have to almost apply for a position. Then you get a chance to play, you prove yourself, and you get a scholarship. And that's just a marvelous story.
Gordon rifling one up to the right side. Too low and too long for Kenny Simon. Well, each week, Hardee's has been honoring an SEC student-athlete who gives back to the community. This week's Hardee's Rise and Shine for Community Service SEC student-athlete of the week, Vanderbilt's Kelly Dougherty, senior member of the Lady Commodore basketball team, an active volunteer at the Edge Hill Community Center in Nashville, also has been recognized by the civic group 100 Black Women for community service involvement. Hardee's with a tip of the cap. Vanderbilt's Kelly Dougherty will donate $500 to the United Way in her honor. Eric Lewis on the carry. And the tackle made by Trey Teague, who fought off a blocker and made the tackle. Trey's a redshirt freshman out of University School in Jackson, Tennessee. Former high school All-American there. He goes a slim 6'5", 281 at right tackle. A presence to reckon with in the next couple of years. They've got Bill Duff, a redshirt freshman, also helping out there. He's a Jersey kid who goes 6'3", 262. A lot of good young players in the way for this Tennessee defense. Minute 20, third quarter. And Gordon's pass batted down. Billy Barron, who got the start today.
Boy, what a good rush there on the backside by Jonathan Brown, 91. Barron's going to be in front of Gordon to knock the football down, but watch after the ball gets knocked down. You can't see it. Wham! Boy, did Gordon take a shot in the back by Jonathan Brown.
Oddly enough, Vanderbilt's first punt of the second half coming up. But the problem is they've been turning it over, not punting it.
Milo Silver's back there. That's up there.
Well, it's Sean Summers this time. Ball short of him. And it'll roll dead around the 33 after a 37-yard kick.
They're going to bring Gordon in the quarterback. No,
we'll wait a while. Brandon Stewart. And they've got a defensive struggle going in Oxford today. That's an emotional ball game for those two clubs in the Egg Bowl. Mississippi State winning 3-0. Bulldogs have had a good year. They are 7-3, headed for a pretty good bowl game. Had a chance to beat Bama a couple of weeks ago. A lot of teams can say they've had a chance to beat Alabama. Nobody's done it.
Well, they lost a lot of first half of ball games, Alabama did, but their second halves have been just marvelous. And then what do they do against Auburn? They come and score all those points in the first half and hang on to win.
Yeah, Jay Parker comes up big when Georgia threatens them at home and plays well offensively, gets a late drive for a touchdown.
I know you and I have disagreed about Jay Barker, but you know, over Eric Zier. But boy, I'll tell you, when you got a guy, what is Barker, 34-1-1, I think he is. It's awfully hard to pick against him for all conference. But I'll give you credit because Zier certainly is a wonderful talent.
Coming across the line of scrimmage is James Manley.
Still same results.
It was drawn off.
Yeah, that was the center. I think the center snapped the ball, kind of moved the football and drew him off some.
Gibson, the sophomore. And we go to the fourth quarter. Finally, 58-0 Tennessee with 15 minutes of football remaining in the regular season of the Southeastern Conference. Yes, it's 58-0 with the fourth quarter about to commence. Tennessee with the football. Second and 7 coming up at their own 34-and-a-half-yard line. There's our Lee Apparel game summary after three quarters. I guess the numbers tell the story. Only 61 yards on the ground for Vandy, averaging about 236 a game. When you fall so far behind, you really can't run the ball that much. There's Jay Graham, and James Manley wraps him up. And while we were on our break between the third and fourth quarters, Aaron Hayden was wheeled out. Tennessee fans acknowledging him, and boy, what a terrible injury that was. We wish him well for a speedy recovery, but his football days at Tennessee are over.
Accident the way it happened, rolled up on his leg. He's got it caught up underneath him.
Third down and 5. Stewart and Collins got it. Looked like Brandon didn't have a whole lot of patience to wait for somebody to break open, so he was thinking about running. And that's when Gerald Collins smelled blood. 9 tackles on the day for the linebacker.
This is impatience right here. This is about the first thing that's gone wrong. Gerald Collins in there on the stop.
Hey, we're going to see a punt by the Volunteers. I think we only saw, what, 2 last week. Here's Tom Hutton. And that is Sanford Ware back for Vandy. And a high one carries down to the 21. Sanford Ware. Flag flies. He gets a yard or so after a good-looking 45-yard kick by the senior Tom Hutton.
Well, I think one of the things that really has to be discouraging for Jerry DiNardo is that they felt their team was really coming of age. It was maturing. This is a terrible setback. Just terrible. Hurts your recruiting, kind of puts a bad taste in your mouth for the rest of the year. It's just kind of tough to overcome this. But he's got all the earmarks.
Run back, blocking the back. 10 yards, first down.
You know, Dave, I think the thing it does, you start to doubt yourself a little bit. Do we belong on the same field with Tennessee? You know, we've beaten some other good teams. We haven't beaten Alabama, but we've always played them tough. Vandy's always played Florida tough. But something about these Volunteers, they looked a little tense early in the game. Remember those unforced fumbles early?
Exactly.
Vandy might have been too tight coming into this one, and I'm not sure there's anything Jerry DiNardo could do about that. A deep drop by Gordon. And the ball is tipped, almost intercepted. Getting a piece of it was Steve Johnson. Gabe Banks, the intended receiver. Johnson had a chance at that first ever INT. He's a true freshman out of Powder Springs, Florida.
And watch it hit him right in the chest. Bam. And then someone else coming for it.
That looked like Nick Jester taking a shot at it.
But one of the things, again, you know, you talk about DiNardo and his team. This does not look like the team that played Florida so well. That was such a marvelous football game for him to keep it so close. I think that's the closest score that Florida's had this year other than the Auburn game.
24-7 Gators, their third lowest point scored of the year. And running the ball well off the left side, first time today. Cliff Deese, the junior tailback. Another Texas kid out of Houston's Westfield High School. Another player injured.
Bill Duff.
Looks like Bill Duff, number 50. Nope.
Troy Edge, the injured.
That's Troy Edge. So another injured player. We've had several of them today. Now here's a look at what's coming up next week. The only two teams ever to play in the SEC championship game, the Gators and the Tide, go at it again next week. And the interesting thing here is, look at the rating of both teams. Bama third in the AP poll, Florida is fourth. A combined record of 19-1. Florida is hammering Florida State today. That really sets the stage for an outstanding football game at 3:30 next Saturday.
Yeah, they'll probably be out front selling tickets trying to fill that one.
Yeah, sure.
Well, that's going to be a great game.
And, of course, the fanfare and all the other things, the Southeastern Conference. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wasn't it 31-3?
It was 30. It was 31. I thought it was 31-3.
It was.
Wow. Say there's 30 seconds left in the fourth quarter in that game. 31-31.
Torrey Edge taking off now. That's unbelievable. Well, certainly losing a game like that would doom any slim hope that Florida has of a national championship. They consider themselves still in the hunt. Bama is right in the middle of everything. You know, Dave, we were talking about the scenario. If Miami would beat Nebraska in the Orange Bowl, then you'd kind of take your pick between Penn State and Alabama, and a lot of people feel that if Bama wins the SEC championship game after beating Auburn and then wins the Sugar Bowl, that people might leapfrog them right over your Nittany Lions.
Well, it certainly would be understandable, because Penn State's going to play a fine Oregon team, but not a team like Alabama's going to play in the Sugar Bowl if in fact they make that game.
First down at the 28 for Vanderbilt. Ronnie Gordon will option right, and he will pitch. Cliff Deese trying to turn up field, and he's cracked down at about the 43-yard line. There's a flag at the 37.
Picked up by number 30, Corey Gaines of Tennessee.
Corey Gaines on the tackle. And this is one of those situations where you have a lot of players out there who don't normally play that much. And
holding on the run, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, still first down.
Holding against Vanderbilt.
Well, you start looking at a game like this, I do, from a player standpoint, you say, where did it go wrong? When you start looking at the beginning series, they just started off, like you said, so tense.
Yeah, I was going to say, you might want to look at the opening kickoff. Let's check in with Bob Kessling.
You know, it's interesting. Kevin Mays is the senior co-captain of the Tennessee Volunteers. Mays is a guy from Kingston, Tennessee, and has a lot of pride in Tennessee. He was recruited heavily by Notre Dame, but decided to come and play at his hometown, Tennessee. And so he said he didn't know he was even named captain. They named it on Monday, but he didn't go to practice on Monday because he's got a class. So when he arrived Tuesday at the football complex, everybody told him he was named the co-captain of the Volunteers. He said it's the highest honor he's ever had in his life.
And very deservedly so. That's John Emery on that tackle. a sophomore out of Norco, Louisiana. And how about that? Florida State comes back and ties Florida. So the Gators end up 9-1-1. The Seminoles end up 9-1-1. Boy, a four-touchdown lead. And the Gators, of course, go to the SEC championship game against Bama.
Can you imagine what that halftime was like? You're down 31-3. You're at home. You come back and score 28 points in the second half.
Gordon with a little sway pass out to the tight end, Jason Tomacek. I know what happened. Bobby Bowden called Terry and said, what can I do in the second half? Rub off some of that second half magic on me, will you, son? And I guess he did. Jason Tomacek, a sophomore out of Franklin Road Academy right here in Nashville. Tennessee flag flying high in the capital city today. Clock runs with 11:15 left in the football game. 58-0 Volunteers.
Vanderbilt in no hurry to run plays. They're down under 6 seconds. They don't care.
Third down and 8. And Gordon with a drop. Ball off the hands of Sanford Ware. Might have heard the footsteps approaching. Steve Johnson was tightening on him, and the Commodores will kick the football away.
Well, you've got to mix the football up, and that's just one of the things that Vanderbilt's not been able to do today. You've got to mix that pass up, that run up along with the pass, and kind of keep them off so the defense doesn't creep up on you. But they have just not been non-existent on both the running game and the passing game.
Shanks it a bit. Ball to Sean Summers. And he will have his jersey pulled, and he goes down about the 43-yard line. Eric Vance on the tackle for the Commodores after a 32-yard kick. 10:45 to go. 58, zip. 10:45 to go on a cool and wet Saturday afternoon, late November in Nashville. Tennessee Volunteers with the football back, leading 58-0. Bob Carpenter, Dave Rowe, Bob Kessling at Dudley Field. Brandon Stewart comes out throwing. And the ball complete, out to the right side. And we're not sure who that player is. We'll have to check our traveling roster of Tennessee. They got a lot of extra people in there.
Well, the announcer said Sexton.
He's not on the flip chart, but he was the man who made the catch.
Well, let's give
Scott,
some credit.
That's Scott Sexton. Normally wears number 9, but he put on number 8 today. So now we've located
him on the carry.
And then there's Jay Graham. We know all about his numbers today. Number 25 came on in the third quarter. And he's had a pretty good second half carrying the football. Volunteers will move the chains with 10 and a half minutes to go.
First and 10, ball at the Vanderbilt 44.
There's Tank Neal, who wasn't hurt as badly with that right knee as badly as we thought originally. Sprained it a bit. And there's Graham. Hit from behind by Matt Schuckman. At the right defensive end, where the Commodores lost some outstanding players from a year ago, Alec Young and John DeWitt. That takes some strong crutches to hold up the tank.
Does it ever?
Keep your spirits up, Vandy fan. 5-6 for the Commodores this year. Some play action. Stewart will roll. He'll cut upfield to stay in bounds and keep that clock moving. And Matt Anderson close by on the hit.
You wonder why they're trying to pass the football in this situation. You want to just keep your offense in tempo. Sure, you want to run the clock. Don't go out of bounds. But you just basically want to keep your offense tempo going. Keep those linemen blocking. Get a lot of experience for the younger players. You got backup players in there that need opportunities, what they call takes, where they get the opportunity to both carry and receive.
First down at the 32. And Jay Graham working off the right side. Good yardage on first down. Well, if the Tennessee offense has had tempo today, it must be about 78 RPMs. It's been 33 1/3 or less for Vandy. They've just had a terrible day. And a tight ball game continues. They're starting to score some points now in Oxford as the Bulldogs pick up the Rebels 15-14. We'll keep track of that one for you until we get off the air. 8:45 to go in the ball game. Tennessee chewing up clock here. Jay Graham straight ahead. That's another first down, and he will score. A 25-yard run for Jay Graham.
Boy, no one in the secondary. When he broke through the line of scrimmage, there was no one there. Big blocks up front by those linemen. They just split him. And when he bursts into the secondary, watch how quickly he gets there. Right now, no one's going to touch him. There's no one even close to him. Just prances into the end zone.
And Jay Graham with his second rushing touchdown of the year.
How many yards has he got?
Thanks for the point after.
How about 121 in a quarter and a half?
I was just going to say, he didn't come in until the third quarter.
Next for it. With another one. And it's 65-0 Tennessee with 8:33 remaining. Tennessee huge. 65-0 with 8:33 remaining. And the Commodores about to receive it. Ball at the 12 by Gabe Banks. Tries to crash his way through that first wave. And out to about the 28-yard line.
Well, reassemble the troops. That's what they're saying on Vanderbilt's sideline. Let's reassemble the troops. Let's see if we can get a little bit of dignity. Let's see if we can score. I can't remember. I remember one time they crossed into Tennessee's field position. I don't know how many times they've been in Tennessee's territory, but it hasn't been very much today. Haven't put any drives together, haven't put first downs together, haven't moved the chains. They have just had a disaster.
Gordon with a deep drop. Out to the right he goes with Duff chasing it. And out of bounds on the near side. Let's check in with Bob Kessler.
One guy that might be really enjoying today's game is George Kaffigo, a Hall of Famer at Tennessee back in 1939. Coach Kaffigo then was a member of the coaching staff for 20 years from 64 to 84. In fact, he was in charge of the Tennessee kicking game, so he'll really enjoy Beckford's performance today. Coach Kaffigo is the guy who instituted the last tackle regime. He didn't like Vanderbilt very much and really put a lot into this rivalry. Coach Kaffigo is a little bit under the weather, and so we wish him the best and hope he gets better. And I'm sure that today's game and the performance by Tennessee is making him feel a lot better.
65-0. That ought to cure whatever ails you. You've got orange on. Second down and 11. Gordon to Sanford Ware. Nick Jester wrapped him up. Ware was trying to get out of bounds.
Why? Why was he trying to get out of bounds?
Fundamental football. Fundamental football.
That's right.
Fourth quarter, you catch a pass when you're trailing, you start thinking about the sideline. Clock will run under 8 minutes now. Commodores will end up 5-6.
Pick up a four on the play. It'll be third down.
It'll be third down and seven. And that close in huddle. Center turns around, takes about two steps. Jerry DiNardo's name has been kicked around a little bit the last week or two regarding some open head coaching jobs around the country. Gordon off the hands of Sanford Ware. And Vanderbilt will have to kick it again. Jerry's name has popped up a couple of times by some reporters in Oklahoma regarding the Sooners head coaching job. And the latest is Colorado. Jerry was Bill McCartney's defensive coordinator out there before coming to Vanderbilt. And that certainly is an outstanding program. That, ironically, wears black and gold as well.
Well, I think you have to look at his overall program, what he's done here. I believe he came in with what, back-to-back 1-10 records and immediately made them a contender.
Good-looking kick by Bill Marinangel. At the 27, Nilo Sylvan, and he gets through again. You know, it can't be a fluke the way this guy keeps returning punts. Nobody's been able to tackle him the last 3 or 4 weeks. 7:17 to go. Fouls by 65 as they get the ball back. Welcome back to Nashville. Todd Helton has come into play quarterback for Tennessee. And Major League Baseball scouts are shivering right now. He's expected to be a top five pick in the 95 baseball draft. Injured against Mississippi State several weeks ago. He's in there to hand it off. And why not give it to Jay Graham, who's having a career day. Jay ran for 99 yards last year, 154 this year, and a big day today. And Jay gets to play, or Todd, excuse me, gets to play one play. And then Lance Wheaton's back in there.
Hey.
He's becoming a regular.
His biggest pass, they said, was in the orange and white game in spring game.
And he will give it to Eric Lane. Ryan Boykin tackles him. Some of those Vanderbilt starters are still in there battling. Lance Wheaton, a senior quarterback out of Kingston, Tennessee. He's the man John Bexford has hold for him.
Yeah, you don't want to get him hurt. Well, it's got to be a thrill for him. Walk on, he's had, over his career, Wheaton has had to try to be kind of representative of all the different quarterbacks of the SEC, and now he's getting a chance to play.
Flag flies before the play on second and one.
Before the ball was snapped, encroachment by the offense. Still second down.
Let's check in with Bob Kessler.
I talked to Lance after last week's game with Kentucky, and I said, you didn't throw the ball, did you want to? He said, yeah, I did. The problem was the coaches, if they signaled a pass play, they'd think I was Jay Barker or Terry Dean or somebody, and I'd throw the Alabama play instead of the Tennessee play. So maybe I'll get the throw one today.
And look at this carry by Eric Lane. Yeah, Lance Wheaton is the biggest imposter on the Tennessee team. He's always pretending he's somebody else.
Well, what they do every week, you have what they call scout squads. Lance is the scout squad quarterback. Every week he puts on a jersey of a Southeast Conference quarterback, and he pretends he is that quarterback, runs the plays of the scout team. That's a big factor in defense. Believe me, you need someone to do that, and evidently he's done well.
First down at the 18. And the give is to Gray Barker, a freshman out of Humboldt High School. 5'11", 221.
Barker on the carry for Tennessee.
5:30 remaining. Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouses invites you to come by and register for a trip for two to the Outback Steakhouse Gator Bowl. Airfare, accommodations, tickets, all provided by Lowe's. Lowe's knows home improvement.
Don't you know that Lance Wheaton's itching to pass that football? Said, okay, now second down and 12. He looks over here and says, hey, coach, can I throw one? Nah, you got to keep it on the ground. A couple more plays. Now he gets a chance.
Ball carried there. Neil Kearney.
And look at Wheaton. He walks all the way over here in front of the coach saying, coach, we need to throw it this time.
Well, he's probably over there trying to find out the play. I doubt if Lance is out there calling his own plays.
Well, great opportunity for him.
Third down and 12. 4:40 remaining.
I say he's going to throw it.
Look at that total offense. 668 yards. There's Kearney, and wrapping him up is Matt Schuckman.
Let him throw it one time, coach.
Well, Philip Fulmer's a pretty smart guy.
He certainly is.
He's not going to sacrifice a team image for a little individual fun. In fact, they may just run it one more time here on 4th and 14.
Yeah, I would look for that too.
Field goal kicking team is done for the day.
Well, anybody who's played this game has been on the both ends of this type of a game. You've been on a game where nothing's gone right, and now today nothing's gone wrong.
4th and 14.
4th and 14. Yeah, see, that's Fulmer. He's a class act. He's not going to put the ball in the air. Gray Barker again on the carry. It'll go over on downs. And Vanderbilt will have it back with 3:38 remaining. Gray Barker one of those guys who didn't even have a number in the preseason media guide, gets a chance to carry it. And Jerry DiNardo sends out Gabe Banks, Jason Tomacek, and company one more time. Got a lot of folks to thank and salute for their outstanding work on our Jefferson Pilot SEC crew throughout the 1994 season. Our 13th week together. We're not even sick of each other yet. Damian Allen, the quarterback. He will option left and keep. Nice cut up field. And he will stay in bounds out around the 34-yard line. Our man in Charlotte who kind of makes it all happen for us, Jimmy Rayburn, who couldn't be with us this weekend. Wendy Voigt, our executive producer, is here with us. There they are. Those are the big bosses. They get to go first.
Well, Wendy took us to dinner last night, so let's mention her.
Well, she should be on top then.
That's right.
And Rob Reichle, who's produced several of our games, along with Beverly Rumley this year, our director Ken Dennis. Thanks to Ken.
Mr. Intensity.
Yeah. Took an injury the first week of the season. He's been playing hurt for the last 3 months.
Paul Morgan on the carry.
Mike Voigt, Scott Snyder, the pride of East Carolina University. At least that's what he says. Melinda Mazo, a former Tar Heel. Our EIC, Don Karcher, and Paul Kidd, who keeps us all plugged in and powered up. Nick in video, Russ and Cal handling our tape. Now that's a Burger King starting lineup. Second down and four at the 40.
Burger King starting lineup.
Yeah.
You're going to get the big burger for that one. A Whopper.
Here's Cliff Deeks. And he's out around the 45-yard line. There are more folks. Dave and Dennis are audio guys. Announcers always appreciate good audio. And our camera people who have to work outside under a lot of difficult circumstances. The fourth quarter in Starkville comes to mind.
Yes.
All those half times in Gainesville and places like that where we had a lot of rain.
Hey, they even mentioned Kim in there.
Yeah, he's been with us for 3 years. And some of our other stat guys like Scott McKinney and Joel Alterman who help us out from time to time. 2 minutes to go. On a roll. And the ball caught and then dropped. Bobby Jackson, the intended receiver.
Well, keep up the good work. You're doing a good job on those names.
Bobby Jackson incomplete.
I don't know how we get up on that satellite, but we thank those folks. It's all amazing to me how we get this from here to you.
Second down 10, ball remains at the 46.
And a mention for our graphics operator, Carol Van Norman, who works with Scott Snyder. Yeah, the girl who typed all of that forgot to put her own name in there, so we give her a verbal mention.
Well, we give her two mentions. First of all, for being a great graphics operator, but secondly, for working with Scott.
Second down at the 46. Allen keeping it. Nice cut. And he's down to the 40, a little bit beyond, as they get into Tennessee territory. And the clock will stop as the chains move with a minute 46 remaining. Dave, it's been great having you come aboard on our crew this year.
Well, thank you. It's been wonderful.
Tennessee, a large margin of victory today, and I mean large. But not quite what they did to Tennessee Tech 43 years ago. When Dave was a senior at Penn State. Allen rolling left, option, keeper, and taken down from behind by number 70, Trey T. So the Volunteers will go 7-4. They will finish 5-3 in league play. Commodores will fall to 5-6 and end up 2-6 in the SEC.
And Bob, it's just been a marvelous recovery for Tennessee. You know, to lose your quarterback in that first game and then to regroup and find the two quarterbacks that they found, it was just a marvelous recovery for them. And since they made those defensive changes at Mississippi State when they had such a terrible game, they have played outstanding football.
Movement all over the place. I thought the defense moved first, then the offensive line actually drew them off. And it looks like they'll mark it off against the Commodores.
For the ball snap, movement by the offense, still second down.
Over in Little Rock, LSU and Arkansas with a defensive struggle in the third quarter.
Man, we love you, man. You
And maybe a final look at the game in Oxford that has the Bulldogs up by four as they approach halftime. Jackie Sherrill's team trying to go 8-3 with a win in the Egg Bowl today. Allen will throw. He will complete it. That's Dwayne Todd, number 37, the true freshman out of Clearview High School up in Ohio. Congratulations, John Bexport. The all-time consecutive PAT record in NCAA history.
As we say, who'd have thunk it? 2 weeks ago, he needed, what, 12 kicks? He got them.
Board wide receivers on the last play of the game. First down at the 24. Allen into the end zone. And it's incomplete, and the game is over. Philip Homer's Volunteers. In a rivalry game, do something that doesn't happen very often in a rivalry. They win, and they win huge. 65-0 at Vanderbilt. And the Volunteers will go 7-4 in the year. A possibility of cracking into the AP top 25.
Well, if they're playing the last few weeks, I would certainly think they're a top 20, top 25 team. They have played great football. As I said, great recovery back from the injury to Colquitt. Found two quarterbacks in Stewart and Manning, and they've played just outstanding football. You look at the scores they've run up the last 4 weeks, they have just had an outstanding last 6 weeks of football.
Tennessee started off the year 1-3, losing at number 14 UCLA, winning at Georgia, then being shut out 31-0 at home by Florida, and then in a game marred by second half turnovers, losing 24-21 at Mississippi State. James Stewart got it going, so did the Volunteers. He's our player of the game for Tennessee today, and Bill Marinangel, who is very busy kicking the football, is our player of the game for the Vanderbilt Commodores as part of our Players of the Game Award scholarship program. Jefferson Pilot Sports will donate $2,000 to the Southeastern Conference to be distributed among its member institutions. Record-setting day for John Bexford and another guy who can run the football pretty well. James Stewart is with Bob Kessler.
James, congratulations on the record, first of all.
Oh, yeah. It was a great job that the offensive line did, making holes for me and Aaron Hayden. Unfortunately, you know, he got hurt, and our sympathies go out with him and his family.
Yeah, did you talk to him at halftime or any time?
No, I didn't get a chance to, and I really wished I had. Our sympathies go out to him and his family. They, you know, just an unfortunate accident.
You got the record early, though. Got it out of the way.
Yeah, I was kind of happy and hoping that I did that because me and Aaron had talked about it, and I wanted him to, you know, get closer to, you know, to number one, you know, number three or whatever. In rushing, leading rushing. So I wanted him to get closer, so I wanted to get my rep earlier.
Right away, James. Over 1,000 yards, too, for James Little Man Stewart.
Yeah, I got your little man, 6'1", 218, 65-0 Vols.